jnana timirandhasya jnananjana shalakaya chakshurunmilitam yena tasmai shri gurave namaha nama om vishnu padaya krishna preshthaya bhutale shrimate bhakti vedanta swaminiti namine namaste saraswati deve gauravani pracharine Nirvishesha Sunyavadi Paschatya Deshatarine Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Shri Vasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama Rama Rama, Rama Hare Hare. Thank you very much and welcome to the episode 18 of Strengthening Foundation series. And today's topic is, as you can see, importance of Ekādaśī. So, we have a lot to cover. So, I will quickly start on this topic. Oops. Krishna. So, importance of Ekādaśī. So, it is one of the most important days to follow as a Vaishnava, and we have to observe this Ekādaśī-vrata. Of course, the real strictures, the strictures means the strict following, I mean strict vow of Ekādaśī is very, very stringent. But Śrīla Prabhupāda has very much gave a very simple formula for us, but still it involves many factors, so we need to understand all that. So, first of all, we will understand some history from the Puranas about how actually this Ekādaśī came about. And then we will go to some excerpts from Śrīla Prabhupāda's books. And what is the Mahādvādaśī? Because sometimes Ekādaśī is followed on the Mahādvādaśī day. So, what is that exactly? And what we can and cannot eat on Ekādaśī. So, these are the topics for today. So, it can take quite a while, so we will begin right away. Hare Krishna. So, stories of Ekādaśī. First is from Padma Purāṇa. So, I have actually sourced these stories from devotees' articles on the internet. So, I have read this many years back, but it's a good refresh for me. And I just put it here because, as we know, if you have watched this series, sometimes there is some lag in the, you know, when we open more tabs on the internet browser. So, I just put it all here. Okay, this is from the Padma Purāṇa, the story of Ekādaśī. So, Ekādaśī, for those who are not, you know, from Indian background. So, Ekādaśī, the word Ekādaśī means, Eka means one, Dasha means 10. So, 1 and 10, 11. Ekādaśī means the 11th day of the fortnight. So, either the waning fortnight or the waxing fortnight. So, the moon takes 15 days for going from new moon to full moon and from full moon to new moon. So, the 11th day is the Ekādaśī day. So, it comes twice a month. This article was originally written in 1956 by Sri Navin Chandra Chakravarti, a disciple of Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, and in 1979 translated into English by Venkat Das Brahmachari. So, in 1956, this was in, I think, Bengali if I am not wrong, so, original article. So, that original article was translated into English in 1979. So, many devotees are very inquisitive about the appearance of Sri Ekādaśī and about her special characteristics. Therefore, I am presenting this description from the 14th chapter of the Padma Purāṇa from the section entitled Kriya Sagar Sara. Once the great sage Jaimini Rishi said to his spiritual master Śrīla Vyāsadeva, O Gurudev, previously by your mercy, you described to me the history of the glories of the Ganga river, the benefits of worshipping Vishnu, the giving of grains in charity, the giving of water in charity, and the magnanimity of drinking the water that has washed the feet of the brahmanas. O best of the sages, Sri Guru, Now, with great enthusiasm, I desire to hear the benefits of fasting on Ekadashi and the appearance of Ekadashi. I hope this text size is visible for you all. So this is in Sanskrit, I will just go to the English. O Gurudev, when did Ekadashi take birth and from whom did she appear? What are the rules of fasting on the Ekadashi? Please describe the benefits of following this vow and when it should be followed. Who is the utmost worshipable presiding deity of Sri Ekadashi? What are the faults in not following Ekadashi properly? Please bestow your mercy upon me and tell about these subjects as you are the only personality able to do so. Śrīla Vyāsadeva, upon hearing this inquiry of Jaimini Rishi, became situated in transcendental bliss. O Brahmana sage Jaimini, the results of following Ekadashi can only be perfectly described by the Supreme Lord Nārāyaṇa, because Sri Nārāyaṇa is the only personality capable of describing them in full. But I will give a brief description in answer to your question. At the beginning of the material creation, okay, before we go further, so already Śrīla Vyāsadeva said, I will describe it in brief. So actually this presentation is in even brief, because there are stories for each and every Ekadashi. There are 26 Ekadashis, 24 usually, in 12 months there are 2 each. But in Purushottam Mas, which comes in the third year, every 3 years, then that is a lunar leap year. So solar leap year comes once in 4 years, whereas lunar leap year comes once in 3 years. So we have one extra month in that year, and in that month there are 2 more Ekadashis, so it's 26 Ekadashis. So each of these Ekadashis have a different story in the Puranas. So we are not going through all that now, maybe some other time, I don't know, but for now we will just understand the main significance of Ekadashi and what to follow and how to follow. At the beginning of the material creation, the Supreme Lord created the moving and non-moving living entities within this world made of 5 gross material elements. Simultaneously, for the purpose of punishing the human beings, He created a personality whose form was the embodiment of sin, Papa Purusha. The different limbs of this personality were constructed of the various sinful activities. His head was made out of the sin of murdering a Brahmana. His 2 eyes were the form of the sin of drinking intoxicants. His mouth was made of the sin of stealing gold. His ears were the form of the sin of having illicit connection with the spiritual master's wife, not just with any other woman, spiritual master's wife. His ears. His nose of the sin of killing one's wife. His arms the form of the sin of killing a cow. His neck made of the sin of stealing accumulated wealth. His chest of the sin of abortion. His lower chest of the sin of having sex with another's wife. His stomach of the sin of killing one's relatives. His navel of the sins of the sin of killing those who are dependent on him. His waist of the sin of self-appraisal. His thighs of the sin of offending the guru. His genital of the sin of selling one's daughter. His buttocks of the sin of telling confidential matters. His feet of the sin of killing one's father. And his hair the form of lesser, less severe sinful activities. In this way, a horrible personality embodying all the sinful activities and vices was created. His bodily color is black and his eyes are yellow. He inflicts extreme misery upon sinful persons. So if you want to imagine how he looks like, this is like a black and white version of it. So this is Papa Purusha. So the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Lord Vishnu, upon seeing this personality of sin. If you want to see him in full, let's see him in full. I don't know what is the benefit of taking his darshan, but we will just so that, you know, we can get an idea how he was conceived. I don't know, I couldn't find her. I did a very small search, so I couldn't find a color picture of him. Maybe somebody did it, but this is just a black and white one. So you get the idea, I guess. There you can see. So as I'm zooming in and out, it's taking quite long to actually, respond. So I'll just go back to the original size again, and we will continue with the narration. Okay. The Supreme Personality of Godhead, Lord Vishnu, upon seeing this personality of sin, began to think to himself as follows: I am the creator of the miseries and happiness for the living entities. I am their master because I have created this personality of sin who gives distress to all dishonest, deceitful and sinful persons. Now I must create someone who will control this personality. At this time Sri Bhagavan created the personality known as Yamaraj and the different hellish planetary systems. Those living entities who are very sinful will be sent after death to Yamaraj, who will in turn, according to their sins, send them to a hellish region to suffer. And then this Papa Purusha will take care of the suffering of them. After these adjustments had been made, the Supreme Lord, who is the giver of distress and happiness to the living entities, went to the house of Yamaraj with the help of Garuda, the king of birds. So here we need to understand that the Lord is actually not willingly the giver of distress and happiness of the living entities. So it is because of our perverted desires. Just like a judge, he is considered the giver of distress or happiness, usually distress. Yeah, he gives happiness to those who won the case, but he gives distress to those who have lost the case. Although he is considered to be the giver, but the real decider, I mean the real factor in playing in those, situations is the activities of the person, the criminal himself. So although it is superficially that, the judge is passing the sentence, but actually he is just executing the law which is already there. So the Lord is never to be blamed for our actions. Namam karmani limpante name karma phala spriha. And also in the 5th chapter, 15th verse, we will go to that. I think we will go there and come back because it is important to understand this. Some people blame the Lord, that's why we have to... One second, I will just... Because many times when somebody suffers, they immediately blame the Lord. Without even thinking for a second, they will just blame the Lord. So, in the 5th chapter, 15th verse of Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, Nadatte kaschachit papam. It's already gone somewhere. Nadatte kaschachit papam nachaiva sukritam vibhuhu agyanenavritam jnanam tena muhyanta jantavaha. Chapter 5, text 15. So, as usual, this software is just going on and on. We will try to... Actually, it is good to... I'm just unable to get to the translation. So this is why I try to avoid this software actually while going live lately. Okay. Nor does this Supreme Lord assume anyone's sinful or pious activities. Embodied beings, however, are bewildered because of the ignorance which covers their real knowledge. Because of ignorance, everybody commits sin. And in the purport, Prabhupada mentions here, the Sanskrit word Vibhu means the Supreme Lord who is full of unlimited knowledge, riches, strength, fame, beauty and renunciation. He is always satisfied in himself, undisturbed by sinful or pious activities. He does not create a particular situation for any living entity, but the living entity, bewildered by ignorance, desires to be put into certain conditions of life, and thereby his chain of action and reaction begins. A living entity, by superior nature, full of knowledge. Nevertheless, he is prone to be influenced by ignorance due to his limited power. The Lord is omnipotent, but the living entity is not. The Lord is Vibhu or omniscient, but the living entity is Anu or atomic. Because he is a living soul, he has the capacity to desire by his free will. Such desire is fulfilled only by the omnipotent Lord. In other words, the living entities, we are not independent in fulfilling our own desires. Even if I have a material desire, the Lord has to provide for the facility for me to enjoy such desires. And so, when the living entity is bewildered in his desires, the Lord allows him to fulfill those desires, but the Lord is never responsible for the actions and reactions of the particular situation which may be desired. Being in a bewildered condition, therefore, the embodied soul identifies himself with the circumstantial material body and becomes subjected to the temporary misery and happiness of life. The Lord is the constant companion of the living entity as Paramatma or the super soul, and therefore he can understand the desires of the individual soul as one can smell the fragrance of a flower by being near it. So when you are near a flower, you can smell the fragrance. So the Paramatma, he is just near us, and in the same heart he is sitting. Samane vrikshe purusho nimagno. So he is sitting in the same heart. Hridyesha arjuna tishthati ishvara sarva bhutanam. And then he is so close to us, he is smelling our desires. You know, vasana, that's why it's called vasana. Vasana means smell. Vasana also means, you know, even in Bhagavad Gita also in the 15th chapter we find that we are carrying our conceptions from life to life, just like the air carries fragrance or smell. It can be fragrance or it can be stench, depending on whether it's more of goodness or passion or ignorance. So, continuing on, desire is a subtle form of conditioning for the living entity. The Lord fulfills his desire as he deserves. Man proposes and God disposes. The individual is not therefore omnipotent in fulfilling his desires. The Lord, however, can fulfill all desires, and the Lord, being neutral to everyone, does not interfere with the desires of the minute independent living entities. However, when one desires Krishna, the Lord takes special care and encourages one to desire in such a way that one can attain to him and be eternally happy. The Vedic hymns therefore declare, Esha u hi eva sadhu karma karayati tam yam ebhyo lokebhya unninishate. Esha u eva sadhu karma karayati yam adho ninishate. Unninishate. Adho ninishate. So the Lord engages the living entity in pious activities so that he may be elevated. The Lord engages him in impious activities so that he may go to hell. So you see, again, the Lord engages him. It's as if the Lord is making us do all the sins. But no, it's according to our desires. This is from the Kaushitaki Upanishad, chapter 3, text 8. Similarly, the Mahabharata, Vanaparva, 31st chapter 27th verse states, Agyo jantur anishoyam atmanah sukhadukhayo ishvara prerito gachet svargam va svabhram evacha. The living entity is completely dependent in his distress and happiness. By the will of the Supreme, he can go to heaven or hell as a cloud is driven by the air. So why is this said that the Lord is doing it? The Lord is making him do? Because the Lord has no desire to do it. We are forcing the Lord against his desire to do it for us. It's true, Prabhupada said that. We are forcing the Lord against his desire. The Lord does not want us to suffer, but we are forcing the Lord against his desire. That is our minute independence. So he is fulfilling our desire as we want. So because without his anugraha or mercy or grace or help, we cannot do anything. Even if you want to perform a sin, without his help we cannot even perform the sin. So he gives facility, you see, because somebody has to be suppose killed, and then this person he wants to kill. So the Lord arranges these two together, and then this person who wants to kill and the person who has to be killed because of his previous action, they are put together, and this person kills the other person. But then this person, because he has a desire to kill, he will be implicated in another, you know, his own death in another different way. So in this way it is very complex how the Lord arranges everything perfectly according to our desires, who connects with who and how they connect, and you know, all this is very, very complex arrangement. So the Lord does everything in the background, and that's why it is said the Lord does it, but it is our will. Therefore, the embodied soul, by his immemorial desire to avoid Krishna consciousness, causes his own bewilderment. Consequently, although he is constitutionally eternal, blissful and cognizant, due to the littleness of his existence, he forgets his constitutional position of service to the Lord and is thus entrapped by nescience. And under the spell of ignorance, the living entity claims that the Lord is responsible for his conditional existence. You see, under the spell of ignorance, the living entity claims that the Lord is responsible for his conditional existence. Sometimes people ask, why did the Lord put us here when he wants us to go out of here? Why did the Lord even put us in the first place? No, the Lord did not put us. We wanted to come here. So the Lord agreed and he put us here. Of course, without him putting, we cannot come here. But then some may ask, yeah, so since it is within his control that he can put or cannot put it as he likes, why did he allow us to commit sin? He could have saved us from our sinful thoughts and, you know, plans, and he could have saved us and did not allow us the chance to, you know, perform sinful activities so that we can always be happy. Why did he allow it? The reason is, love cannot be forced. Love is not forced. Love has to come from the heart. So the Lord does not force our love for him. So if we want something else, then all right, if that is what you want, okay, I will give you, but it's not going to be good. But since you asked for it, here it is. So that's how the Lord supplies. What is that? Yatha tathyato arthan vedadaha chasvathibhya samabhyaha. So this is from the Ishopanishad, verse 8. So the Lord is maintaining everybody else, and he is providing for the necessities and desires of everyone else. Eko bahunam yo vidadhati kaman, is Kathopanishad. So the Vedanta Sutras, second mandala, first chapter, 34th verse, also confirm this. Vaishamya nairgrahane na sapekshatvat tathahi darshayati. The Lord neither hates nor likes anyone, though he appears to. Na vedakaschit bhagavamschikirshitam tave hamanasya nirnam vidambanam nayasya kaschit dayitosti karhiched dveshyasti yasmin vishama amatir nirnam. This is Kunti Devi's prayer in the Canto 1, Chapter 8, Text 29. So she says that people in general have this opinion that you are partial to your devotees and you are against, you are envious towards your non-devotees. But actually this is not so. They don't understand, they are bewildered, they don't understand your pastimes. You are equal to everybody, but it is just, it looks as if in this way, and therefore they are bewildered. So this is Kunti Devi's prayers. I don't want to go there because again it will become slow. So we'll go back to the narration. So he created the Papa Purusha with all the different limbs, and then to control him he created Yamaraj. So that the Papa Purusha can only punish those who are sent to him by Yamaraj. Not that everybody else, you know, he can just ruin. So only Yamaraj, whoever he sends, he will punish them. So after these adjustments had been made, the Supreme Lord, who is the giver of distress and happiness to the living entities, with the background knowledge of the verse we just read, went to the house of Yamaraj with the help of Garuda, the king of birds. When Yamaraj saw that Lord Vishnu had arrived, he immediately washed his feet and made an offering unto him. He then had him sit upon a golden throne. The Supreme Lord Vishnu became seated on a throne, whereupon he heard very loud crying sounds coming from the southern direction. He became surprised by this and thus inquired from Yamaraj, "From where is this loud crying coming?" You think the Lord doesn't know? Does the Lord feel surprised at any time? Surprise is when you do not know something and it just comes like that. So what does the Lord does not know? This is all his Leela. Yamaraj in reply said, "O Deva, the different living entities of the earthly planetary systems have fallen into the hellish regions. They are suffering extremely for their misdeeds. The horrible crying is because of suffering from the inflictions of their past bad karma." After hearing this, the Supreme Lord Vishnu went to the hellish region to the south. When the inhabitants saw who had come, they began to cry even louder. You know, sometimes when the child is crying and when the parents try to, you know, like give some attention to the child, then the child cries even louder to make more, you know, get more attention. So, and it is also, I mean, devotees, when they are in a helpless situation, they cry out for the Lord. Of course, they were not devotees, but the Lord himself came before them for some reason. Then when they started to cry even louder, the heart of the Supreme Lord Vishnu became filled with compassion. Just like a parent, when the child cries even louder, the mother will become okay, softer, you know. So, where is it coming from? It's coming from the Lord. The Lord is, you know, always like the mother and father, he is always affectionate towards us. When the inhabitants saw, okay, they cried louder, and the Supreme Lord's heart became filled with compassion. Lord Vishnu thought to himself, "I have created all this progeny and it is because of me that they are suffering." Of course, it is not because of him. He is just feeling like that. They asked for it. And of course, the Lord gave the facility. One may ask, if the Lord gave the facility for them to enjoy, see, they wanted to enjoy on their own. So why did the Lord not just give them the facility to enjoy? Why did he give them the suffering, which they did not ask for? So it's like this. So everyone who wants to enjoy are put in this material world. And if everyone given the chance wants to enjoy to the maximum. So in other words, everyone will become a Brahma. Right? Everyone wants to be the biggest controller that they can be in this material world. So, and if I encroach upon your happiness and you encroach upon my happiness and there's no law, how can everybody enjoy at the same time? We cannot. How can everybody be a Brahma? Suppose, okay, this man, he wants to enjoy all the women of the world, and another man, he also wants to enjoy all the women of the world, and all the women also want to enjoy all the men of the world. It cannot happen. So there has to be some controlling factor. So that controlling factor is the law of karma. So that everyone can enjoy as they want. You know, just like in any country, there are rules, you know. Otherwise, given a chance, everybody, if there is anarchy, if there is no government, everybody will want to do their best. They will murder someone or they will do anything to get their enjoyment. There's no thinking anymore. Just I want to enjoy whatever I will do. So in that way, it is a complete chaos. So to have at least some peace, there has to be law and order. So that is exactly this law of karma. So if I transgress on somebody else's happiness, then there is karma involved. So in this way, so there is check and balance. So in that way, I can be controlled, you know. So this karma is necessary. Or if everybody is just given a different world because everyone wants to enjoy, with whom he will enjoy? If everyone is in one particular universe, one person in one universe, and with whom he will enjoy. So he needs other people. So we can't be in our own domains of ultimate happiness, you know, competitor of the Lord. So we have to be together. So this material world is that place and the karma is there to regulate all this. Srila Vyasadeva continued, "O Jaimini, just listen to what the Supreme Lord did next." So he said, "I created all this progeny and it is because of me that they are suffering." Then listen to what he did next. So there is Sanskrit, but I'll just go to the English. After the merciful Supreme Lord thought over what he had previously considered, he suddenly manifested from his own body, from his own form, the deity of the lunar day Ekādaśī. Afterwards, the different sinful living entities began to follow the vow of Ekādaśī and were then elevated quickly to the abode of Vaikuntha. O my child Jaimini, therefore the lunar day of Ekādaśī is the self-same form of the Supreme Lord Vishnu and the Supersoul within the heart of the living entities. Shri Ekādaśī is the utmost pious activity and it is situated as the head among all vows. Among all vratas, Ekādaśī-vrata is the chief. Following the ascension of Shri Ekādaśī, that personality who is the form of the sinful activity gradually saw the influence she had. He approached Lord Vishnu with doubts in his heart and began offering many prayers, whereupon Lord Vishnu became very pleased and said, I have become pleased, very pleased by your nice offerings. What boon is it that you want? The Papa Purusha replied, I am your created progeny and it is through me that you wanted distress given to the living entities who are very sinful. But now, by the influence of Shri Ekādaśī, I have become all but destroyed. O Prabhu, after I die, all of your parts and parcels who have accepted material bodies will become liberated and therefore return to the abode of Vaikuntha. If this liberation of all living entities takes place, then who will carry on your activities? There will be no one to enact the pastimes in the earthly planetary systems. You see how he is praying. If everybody goes back to Vaikuntha, then this earth, this material world will be empty and who will do your pastimes here? And how you will do your pastimes here? So he is thinking about the Lord's pastimes, or he is giving an excuse of the Lord's pastimes for his own existence. But because they are actually is created by the Lord, in fact the fact is that this material world is for his enjoyment as well. For example, he wants to show his anger. In the spiritual world there is no anger. So in the material world he came as Narasimha and he tore apart the demon. Such activities are not there in the spiritual world. Those are only there in the material world. The killing of the demons doesn't happen in the spiritual world. So, but he has that spirit of a warrior, spirit of, you know, that anger, everything. So, where he exhibits in this material world. So, this place is also for his own pastimes, for his own leela. But of course, at the same time, there are many rebellious souls. So, for that, for their deliverance also he comes. O Keshava, if you want these eternal pastimes to carry on, then you please save me from the fear of Ekādaśī. No type of pious activity can bind me, but Ekādaśī only, being your own manifested form, can impede me. Out of fear of Shri Ekādaśī, I have fled and taken shelter of men, animals, insects, hills, trees, moving and non-moving living entities, rivers, oceans, forests, heavenly, earthly and hellish planetary systems, demigods and the Gandharvas. I cannot find a place where I can be free from the fear of Shri Ekādaśī. O my master, I am a product of your creation, so therefore very mercifully direct me to a place where I can reside fearlessly. Śrīla Vyāsadeva then said to Jaimini, after saying this, the embodiment of all sinful activities, Papa Purusha, fell down at the feet of the Supreme Lord Vishnu, who is the destroyer of all miseries, and began to cry. After this, Lord Vishnu, observing the condition of the Papa Purusha with laughter, Lord Vishnu was laughing, began to speak thus, O Papa Purusha, rise up, don't lament any longer, just listen, and I'll tell you where you can stay on the auspicious lunar day of Ekādaśī. On the day of Ekādaśī, which is the benefactor of the three worlds, you can take shelter of foodstuffs in the form of grains. There is no reason to worry about this anymore because my form as Sri Ekādaśī Devi will no longer impede you. After giving direction to Papa Purusha, the Supreme Lord Vishnu disappeared and the Papa Purusha returned to the performance of his own activities, which is punishing the sinful. Therefore, those persons who are serious about the ultimate benefit for the soul will never eat grains on the Ekādaśī Tithi. Tithi means the date. According to the instructions of Lord Vishnu, every kind of sinful activity that can be found in the material world takes its residence in the place of foodstuff, grain, especially on Ekādaśī. Whoever follows Ekādaśī is freed from all sins and never enters into hellish regions. If one doesn't follow Ekādaśī because of illusion, he is still considered the utmost sinner. If he doesn't follow Ekadashi because of illusion, he is still considered the utmost sinner. So, all the kind of sins are in the grains on Ekadashi. Even the killing of, you know, here it is said, for every mouthful of grain that is eaten by a resident of the earthly region, one receives the effect of killing millions of brahmanas. It is definitely necessary that one gives up eating grains on Ekadashi. I very strongly say again and again, on Ekadashi, don't eat grains, don't eat grains, don't eat grains. Three times Vyasadeva is saying. Whether one be a Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra or of any family, he should follow the lunar day of Ekadashi. From this, the perfection of Varna and Ashrama will be attained. Especially since even if one by trickery follows Ekadashi, all of his sin become destroyed and he very easily attains the supreme goal, the abode of Vaikuntha. So, this is one story. Now there is another story. This is from the second story, is from the Garga Samhita. This is a conversation between Srimati Radharani and the gopis who were the Yajnasitas of, you know, when Ramachandra Bhagavan was in the Dandakaranya forest when he was in Vanavas. So there were many rishis who wanted to have conjugal relationship with the Lord. And the Lord said, no, this life I am Ekapatni-vrata. I have only one wife. I have vowed to take only one wife. But in my next appearance as Krishna, then you will have the opportunity to associate with me, all of you. So, those rishis have become gopis in the Krishna Leela time. Now, where they came from, everything is stated here. So, this is actually 53 verses in Sanskrit, this part. So, we will now study. I will just read the translations and not the Sanskrit. And the Sanskrit also is not properly formatted, so doesn't matter. We'll just read the English translation. I hope you can see the text. Sri Narada said, O King of Mithila, please hear the story of the Yajnasitas that became gopis, a sacred and auspicious story that fulfills all desires and removes all sins. So, Yajnasitas are those rishis who were in Ramachandra's time. In the south, in a country named Ushinara, where for 10 years it did not rain. Wow, it's very bad. Fearful that it would never rain, the wealthy gopas there travelled. Gopas means the cowherd men who were there in the south. They travelled with their families and cows to the circle of Vraja. From south they went to the Vrindavan. O king, with the help of King Nanda, they made their homes in beautiful and sacred Vrindavan by the shore of the beautiful Yamuna. So these gopas, they came from south to all the way to Vrindavan, Vraja. And Nanda Maharaj, being the king of the Vrindavan, he arranged for their accommodations. He built their houses and everything. In this way, they started staying in Vrindavan. Fearful that it would never rain, the wealthy gopas traveled. Okay, they went to circle of Raja. They have made their homes in beautiful and sacred Vrindavan by the shore of the river Yamuna, beautiful Yamuna. The Yajnasitas, who had received a blessing from Lord Ramachandra, took birth in their homes as beautiful gopis decorated with splendid youthfulness. So, those Yajnasitas became the daughters of these gopas who traveled from the... Now, you see, 10 years of famine or drought. Now, it looks very bad. But you see how the Lord has another plan for that. Because then they travel there and then the gopis, I mean those, you know, those sages took birth there. So, sometimes we do not know why things happen. So, we just have to wait. So then, O King of Kings, when they saw handsome Lord Krishna, they became bewildered with love for him. This bewilderment is not like a, you know, in ignorance. This is complete purity, spiritual agitation. That is not same as lust. So, to ask what vow they might follow to attain Krishna's mercy, they approached Sri Radha. So the gopis approached Radharani to ask her what vow, what vrata should to follow so that I can get Krishna's mercy. The gopis wanted to know. The gopis said, "O Radha, O beautiful lotus-eyed daughter of King Vrishabhanu, please tell us what vow we may follow to attain Lord Krishna's favor. O Radha, you have made Lord Krishna, whom even the great demigods cannot approach, into your submissive servant. You are the most beautiful girl in all the worlds. You have crossed to the farther shore of the deep meaning of all the scriptures." That means she's beyond all scriptures. All the scriptures are to what? To help us navigate the ocean of material existence and go to the other shore, to the kingdom of God. But she has crossed the farther shore of the deep meaning of the scriptures. She is already in love of Godhead, love of Krishna in the most highest and pristine form. So nobody can even match. Sri Radha said, "To attain Lord Krishna's mercy, you should follow the vow of fasting on Ekadasi. In that way, you will make Lord Krishna into your submissive servant. Of this, there is no doubt." The gopis said, "O Radha, please tell us the names of the different Ekadashis throughout the year. Month after month, how should the different Ekadashis be observed?" Sri Radha said, "During the dark fortnight of the month of Margashirsha, November, December, in order to kill the demon Mura, the holy day of Ekadashi was born from the body of Lord Vishnu." So this killing of the Mura demon and in connection with the appearance of Ekadashi, this story I do not know. Maybe we have to do more research. But we have just heard the story of how he created Ekadashi to save the sinful people in the hellish regions. "Desiring your welfare, I will tell you the names of the 26 most sacred Ekadashis that appear in the different months. Their names are Utpatti, Moksha, Safala, Putrada, Shaktila, Jaya, Vijaya, Amalake, Papamochani, Kamada, Varuthini, Mohini, Apara, Nirjala, Yogini, Devasayani, Kamini, Pavitra, Aja, Padma, Indira, Pasankusa, Rama, Prabodhini." These are the 24. "There are also two more Ekadashis, both named Sarvasampatprada, during the extra month of leap year. In this way, there are 26 Ekadashis in all. A person who chants the names of these 26 Ekadashis, attains the result of following Ekadashi for 1 year." Who doesn't like a shortcut? Just chanting the names of these 26 Ekadashis attains the result of following Ekadashi for 1 year. Of course, it doesn't mean that I'll just chant, "This is nice, Prabhu." No. No, but we have to take from our Guru, Srila Prabhupada. So, we have to still follow everything. "O girls of Raja, please hear the rules for observing Ekadashi. On Ekadashi, one should control the senses and sleep on the ground. On Dwadashi, one should eat only once." Everybody likes to eat on Dwadashi, big feast. Prabhu, Ekadashi finished, big feast. But here it is said, on Dwadashi, one should eat only once. Of course, Srila Prabhupada did not enforce all these things. So, but you see, if you want to really follow... "During Ekadashi, one should be pure-hearted and very clean, wear clean garments, drink water only once, rise for Brahma Muhurta and bow down to Lord Krishna. Bathing with well water is an inferior kind of bath. Bathing in a pond is better. Bathing in a lake is better than that. And bathing in a river is better still. In this way, one should bathe. On Ekadashi day, one should be free from greed and anger. And one should not talk to sinful people, atheists and offenders. A person who follows the vow of Ekadasi should not talk to liars, offenders of brahmanas, sinners, debauchees, thieves, adulterers and the ill-behaved and immoral. In the home, one should with devotion in the heart worship Lord Krishna and offer him food and a lamp. Of course, as devotees, we should do this every day, offering him food and lamp. From the Brahmanas, one should hear the stories of Lord Krishna. See, this is very important. We should hear the stories about Lord Krishna on Ekadasi. There should be more reading, more chanting, more service. One should absorb himself in Krishna. One should offer dakshina to them. This is another thing. One should keep a vigil, singing the glories of Lord Krishna throughout the night. That vigil means jagaran. See here. Punah ratrau jagaranam. See. Ratrau jagaranam kuryad gayan krishna padanicha. Katah shrutva brahmanebhyo dadyat saddakshinam punaha. Ratrau jagaranam kuryad. Jagaranam means not to sleep. Actually, Ekadashi means from the start of the day. So, don't eat anything and just chant and read and, you know, do service. And then, this whole day not sleeping, and then in the night also not sleeping until the next day, until the breaking of the fast. So, that is the actual way of doing Ekadashi. Of course, again, Srila Prabhupada did not enforce all this. Just enforce the fasting from grains. Then, when Ekadasi is ended and the Dasami has come, one should avoid these 10 things. I don't know why it is said this. When Ekadasi ended, Dasami day comes. No, actually, when Dasami day ends, Ekadasi comes. I don't know. So, actually, I think it's the other way around. Maybe it's translated wrongly because I don't understand the logic. When Ekadasi has ended and the Dasami day has come. If you see the Sanskrit, Kamsam Mamsam Masurams Chakodravam Chanakam Tathasakam Sakam Madhuprapannam Chapunar Bhojana Maithunam Vishnu Vratetu Kartavyedamsyam Dasha Varjayet Dyutam Kridam Chanidram Chatambulam Dantadhavanam. See, actually, this is actually when Dasami ends and Ekadashi starts. So, eating from a, one should avoid these 10 things. Eating from a brass dish, where are we? Eating flesh, so eating from a brass dish, eating flesh. So, this is meant for even those who are not devotees. So, devotees, of course, they will never eat flesh. But even those who are non-devotees, they should follow the vow of Ekadasi. That is the injunction, actually. So, so for them, if they are meat eaters, they should not eat flesh on Ekadasi. Masur dal, which is the red dal, red lentils. And kodrava grains, chickpeas, spinach, honey, and the food of others, eating twice. That means one should only eat once if one wants to eat. And 10, sex. One should also avoid gambling, playing, sleeping, chewing betel nuts, and brushing the teeth. Even brushing the teeth is not to be done. That is actual way. On Ekadasi, one should avoid harsh speech, slander, theft, violence, sex, anger, and speaking lies. On the Dvadasi, means on the next day, on the 12th day, one should avoid brass utensils, flesh, liquor, honey, oil, speaking lies, pushti, shashti, and masura, masur dal. Actually, as Vaishnavas, we never touch the masur dal at all, the red dal. By following these rules, one should observe the great vow of Ekadashi and Dvadashi. The gopis said, O noble-hearted one, please tell us when the vow of Ekadashi should be observed. What is the result of following Ekadashi? Please tell us. Please tell us in truth the glories of Ekadashi. If Dvadasi starts within the first 22 hours of Ekadashi, one should not fast on Ekadashi but on Dvadasi instead. So, note, one ghatika in fall equals 24 minutes. 55 ghatikas equal 22 hours. So, basically, sometimes we fast on Mahadvadasi. You know, there is, it's not Ekadasi, but not suitable for fasting, it is said. That is because of this. If Dvadashi starts within the first 22 hours of Ekadashi, one should not fast on Ekadashi but on Dvadashi instead. So that is, this is the actual, so Radharani herself is saying this, and also there is the more calculations, we will go to that later on. As one avoids drinking a cup of Ganga water into which a drop of wine has fallen, so one should avoid fasting on such an Ekadashi. That means within 22 hours the Dvadashi comes, then one should not fast on the Ekadashi. Just like Ganga water is very pure, one should take Ganga water immediately. But if a drop of wine has fallen into it, he should not take that Ganga water. So it is said that the example, Dashami phala matrena tyajya chaikadashi tithihi madira bindu patena tyajyo ganga ghato yatha, ganga ghato yatha. Madira means wine, bindu means a drop, patena, fallen. If a drop of wine has fallen into Ganga ghata means a pot of water of Ganga jal. Tyajyo yatha, as we don't drink, that means in other words Ganga jal also should be avoided if there is a drop of wine inside. So that example she is given. So because Ekadashi is as pure as Ganga Devi, which is coming from the feet of the Lord Ganga, and Ekadashi also came from the Lord. So it is as pure as Ganga, but we should not follow it if it is like within 22 hours the Dvadashi comes. And if you ask why so, then I do not know, it's just like that. What can I say? Radharani herself is saying, so I don't know, we just have to accept, that is Shastra. When Ekadashi goes into its completion and Dvadashi arrives at the proper time, then one should fast on Ekadashi. O girls of Vraja, now I will tell you the result of following Ekadashi. Simply by hearing this description, not even following, simply by hearing this description, one attains the result of performing a Vajpaya Yajna. Vajpaya Yajna is a kind of yajna, is one of the seven important yajnas that one does as part of Karmakandiya activities. So it is one of the main yajnas. A person who follows the vow of Ekadashi and Dvadashi attains the same pious result one attains by feeding 88 brahmanas. A person who follows the vow of Ekadashi and Dvadashi attains the same pious result one attains by feeding 88 brahmanas. A person who follows Ekadashi attains a pious result thousands of times greater than the pious result attained from performing the ritual of mixing the earth and the ocean. There is a ritual of mixing the earth and the ocean. For they who are drowning in the ocean of repeated birth and death, an ocean muddy with many sins, the vow of fasting on Ekadashi is the best means of deliverance. Ratrau jagranam kritvai kadasik vratakrin. So even though contaminated with hundreds of sins, a person who keeps a nighttime vigil while following the vow of Ekadashi never sees angry Yamaraj. As a lotus leaf is never touched by water, so a person who worships Lord Krishna with tulsi leaves on Dvadashi is never touched by sin. But as we know, we cannot pluck tulsi leaves on Dvadashi. We cannot pluck tulsi leaves on Dvadashi. So we have to pluck them before Ekadashi, something like that, and then keep them. The result of 1,000 Ashwamedha Yajnas and 100 Rajasuya Yajnas are not equal to even a 16th part of the result of fasting on Ekadashi. 1/16th of the merit of fasting on Ekadashi is more than doing 1,000 Ashwamedha Yajnas and 100 Rajasuya Yajnas. Ashwamedha Sahasraani Rajasuya Shatani Cha Ekadashi Upavasasya kalam narhanti shodashim. Shodasha means 16. Jai Sri Sri Radha Madan Mohan ki Jai. Dasha vai matrike pakshe tatha vai dasha paitrike priyaya dasa pakshe tu purushan uddharen naraha. Priyaya means wife. Dasavai matrike pakshe, tathavai dasa paitrike, priyaya dasa pakshe, tu purushan uddhare naraha. A person who follows Ekadashi delivers 10 generations of his mother's family, 10 generations of his father's family, and 10 generations on his wife's family. Yatha shukla tatha krishna dvayoscha sadrisham phalam dhenuhu shveta tatha krishnau bhyo sadrishim payaha. As a white cow and a black cow both give the same kind of milk, so the Ekadashi of the bright fortnight and the Ekadashi of the dark fortnight both bring the same result. Very nice example, huh? Merumandra matrani papani shata janma janmasu ekam chaikadashim gopyo dahate tulara shivat. O gopis, a fire burns a great pile of cotton. So a single Ekadashi burns the great Mount Meru of sins committed in 100 births. So Mount Meru is the greatest mountain in the universe. Very, very big, especially on the Bhumandala. Very, very big mountain. It's like, I think, how many? 100 yojanas high. 100,000 yojanas high. That means 800,000 miles high, Mount Meru. So this is that big of a mountain of sins committed in 100 births can be burnt by a single Ekadashi following. So, O gopis, when either following the proper method or not following it, and whether it is great or small, one gives charity on Dvadashi, that charity becomes as great as a Mount Meru of charity. Mount Meru, again Meru Mandra. A person who on Ekadashi hears the stories of Lord Krishna attains the same pious result he would attain by giving great charity everywhere on the 7 continents. Ekadashi dine Vishnoha Shrinute yo hare katham sapta dvipavati sapta dvipavati daneyat phalam labhate chasaha. Sapta dvipa, 7 continents. See, the Vedas also, Radharani is also saying 7 continents. We have 7 continents. So our Vedas are, you know, full of complete knowledge. It's not that Radharani did not know geography. She only knows how to love Krishna, she doesn't know anything else. Of course, that loving Krishna includes everything else. So anyway, coming back. A person who bathes at Shankodhara Tirtha and gazes at the deity of the Lord Gadadhar there does not attain even 1/16th of the piety one attains by fasting on Ekadashi. Actually, today is Gadadhar Pandit appearance day. But Gadadhar Pandit is incarnation of Radharani in the Panchatattva. Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda, Shri Advaita Gadadhar. What is Gadadhar? Gada means mace, club. Dhar means one who holds a mace. So actually Lord Narayana's name is Gadadhar because he has a mace, a club, Shankha Chakra Gadapadma. Four things: Shankha, Shkonch, Chakra, the disc, and then the wheel, the Sudarshan wheel, and then Gada. Gada means the mace or the club, and Padma is the lotus flower. So Gadadhar means actually the Lord Narayana, but Gadadhar Pandit also was named in the same way. So this, today is actually his appearance day, by the way. So, but this is not about that Gadadhar, this is the Lord Gadadhar Narayana. A person who makes 400,000 pilgrimages to Prabhas, Prabhasa Kshetra, Kurukshetra, Kedarnath, Badrikashram, Varanasi and Shukra Kshetra during eclipses of the sun and moon and gives great charity there does not attain even 1/16th of the piety one attains by fasting on Ekadashi. 400,000 pilgrimages to all these places and big great charity on the eclipses day, but still less than 1/16th of the piety. So this is to encourage, you know, of course this is true also, but this is to encourage the karmis to do like this, comparing with all the material pious activities. But a devotee is not exactly calculating like this, he is just interested in engaging in more service. He does not want, oh, this much pious, oh, I want piety of 1,000 Ashwamedha yajñas and 100 Rajasoya yajñas, yes, yes. He is not interested. This is to induce the karmis who are interested in all these things to ask them to follow Ekadashi. It is not just lies, it is true also. But for Vaishnavas, they are not for getting any reward out of this. They just want to engage in more service. But we will just read because Radharani also said this. O gopis, as Lord Shesha is the best of serpent, Seshanag, as Garuda is the best of birds, as Lord Vishnu is the best of deities, as the Brahmanas are the best of castes, as the banyan is the best of trees, and as the tulsi leaf is the best of leaves, so fasting on Ekadashi is the best of sacred vows. A person who follows Ekadashi attains the result of performing austerities for 10,000 years. O girls of Raja, now I have described to you the result of following the vow of Ekadashi. Please follow the vow of Ekadashi at once. What more do you wish to hear? So, this is a nice picture of Lord Krishna's lotus feet. Take darshan. So, then we will go to the next story. We are just in the section 1 of it. There are 4 sections. So, this is Ambarish Maharaj and Durvasamani. This is from the Srimad Bhagavatam. So, Srila Prabhupada actually translated this. Now, chapters 4 and 5 of Canto 9 of Srimad Bhagavatam. Now, this story highlights the importance of the Paran time. Paran means, as much as it is important to follow the Ekadashi, Paran means the time of, I mean, the Paran means to break the fast. Paran. So, there is a particular time interval in between which we have to break the fast. That's why we have the time, you know, on Dwadashi. Maybe from, in Singapore, it is like 7-2 to 11-9, around that time usually. I mean, 7 to 11, like that. So, in other places, according to the sunrise, it depends where when it is there. But that 4 hours usually, sometimes it is less for different reasons. But you see, within the time, the breakfast has to be done. Otherwise, if we miss breaking the fast in that time, then our Ekadashi vow is as good as not done. So, this is also a rule. So, why it is like that? Again, I do not know. This is the Lord just gave us like this, we just follow like that. If there is a reason, if the Lord reveals, we will know. If not, we will just follow. Even if the reason is there also, we will still follow. So, anyway, we are following, right? So, that's more important. Our whole thing is to just agree to what the Lord says. Karishya vachanam tava. That is our, devotee means karishya vachanam tava. What is your vachana? What is the meaning of your vachana? What is the logic behind your vachana? That is, does not matter. Karishya vachanam tava. Whatever you say, I will do. Why did you say like this? Why you did not say like that? No, that's not my business. So, this story actually is from the 9th canto, chapters 4 and 5, but this is just a summary of those chapters. So, you will get the entire idea of the story here. So, once Maharaj Ambarish was a great king, you know, great devotee. He engaged all his senses in the service of the Lord. So, once Maharaj Ambarish was worshipping the Supreme Personality of Godhead in Vrindavan, observing the vow of Dwadashi. On Dwadashi, the day after Ekadashi, he was about to break his Ekadashi fast. When he was about to break his Ekadashi fast, because there is a time, no? So, between the time he wanted to break the fast, but then Durvasamuni came. The great mystic yogi Durvasa appeared in his house and became his guest. So, now if you do not know about Durvasamuni is a great sage, mystic yogi, very, very powerful. He is in fact a partial expansion of Rudra, Lord Shiva, and he very easily gets angry also. And if he is pleased, he will give blessings. Like Kunti Devi, she was blessed by Durvasamuni to call any demigod and have a child with her, a child with them. So, Kunti Devi, that's why out of her eagerness, at the age of 16, as a virgin, she wanted to, before even marriage, she wanted to just test out of curiosity. And then she called the Surya the sun god, and he immediately came, and that's how Karna was born. And of course it became, for because of social stigma, she let the child in the river, you know, on a basket, and let the basket on the river, and then somebody else picked up, a washerman. Yeah, so in that way he came to be known as not a Kshatriya, but actually he was a Kshatriya. Anyway, so Durvasamani gave her blessings because he was pleased with Kunti's service as a young girl. And then if he becomes angry, and he will curse also very badly. So this Durvasamani came to as a guest of Ambarish Maharaj and became his guest. So the Vedic culture of receiving a guest, and especially a great guest like Durvasamani, any great sage, sadhu, atithi devo bhava. Atithi means not just any guest. Tithi means what? Tithi means date. So when there is a date and time appointment, that is called tithi. When somebody comes without making an appointment, atithi. Atithi. There is no tithi, there is no appointment made. He just came, barged in. You know, just gate crash. That is called a gate crash. So when somebody gate crashes, that is called atithi. So especially, only one class of people have the privilege of gate crashing into people's houses. Atithi. They are the sadhus, the brahmacharis, the sannyasis. They don't require an invitation from the... they have the right to go to anybody's house. They have the right. Of course, now in Kali Yuga, all those rights are taken away. And they'll put a, you know, no trespassing, you know, you'll be shot dead or something like that. These things are there. If you see 4th Canto, actually, 22nd chapter, verses 9, 10, 11, you know, you will see that a poor man's house is very pious because easily a sadhu can enter that house. But a rich man's house, very, very difficult. And it is just like a, you know, a tree in which venomous snakes live, you know. So, where a sadhu is not allowed into the house, that is actually a house of snakes. So the great guest came, Durvasamani, appeared in the house and became his guest. King Ambarish respectfully received Durvasamani, respectfully received. Not that he put a board there, you know, dogs beware, you know, like... No. So King Ambarish respectfully received Durvasamani, and Durvasamani, after accepting his invitation to eat there, went to bathe in the Yamuna river at noon time. So now Ambarish Maharaj asked him to have eat. So he said, okay, I will eat, but first I will go and bathe in the Yamuna because it was in Vrindavan. So I will bathe in the Yamuna and come out and come back. Because he was absorbed in samadhi, he did not come back very soon. So Durvasamani was lost in meditation. So he did not come. Maharaj Ambarish, however, upon seeing that the time to break the fast was passing, drank a little water in accordance with the advice of the learned brahmanas, just to observe the formality of breaking the fast. So actually he asked, he's a great devotee, so he asked the brahmanas, the council of brahmanas. Every king used to have a council of brahmanas, who will advise him on shastric principles, on what you should do and how you should do, and any difficult situation, how to navigate through the situation. They will give all counsel. So, and they were not paid for that by the state. And they voluntarily do that. So now, he asked the brahmanas, what should I do now that the breakfast time is going to end, and then Durvasamani doesn't come, and as a great guest, and I cannot eat before the guest. That is the etiquette. I cannot eat before the guest. So I have to serve him first. So and then I have to eat. But now what can I do? Now I cannot eat because I have not served my guest. And at the same time I have to eat because the Ekadasi fast is passing. And Ekadasi is very important because it is pleasing to the Lord. So what should I do now? I mean, fix now. Then the brahmana's advice, alright, you do this one thing. You just sip a little bit of water. So water is considered breaking the fast and not breaking the fast. So in that way, you know, you can adjust the situation, what to do. So he said, all right. Then he drank a little bit water. By mystic power, Durvasamani could understand that this had happened. And he was in the Yamuna. You know, then this thing happened, he immediately, you know, woke up. Not, he was not sleeping. I mean, he immediately awoke from his samadhi, from his meditation. he could understand that this had happened and he was very angry. When he returned, he began to chastise Maharaj Amrish, but he was not satisfied. He chastised him a lot, but he was still not satisfied. Then he created from his hair, he plucked out one hair from his head. And from his hair, he created a demon appearing just like the fire of death. Very horrible demon, like a fire, you know. He appeared. The Supreme Personality of Godhead, however, is always the protector of his devotee. And to protect Maharaj Amrish, he sent his disc, the Sudarshan Chakra, which immediately vanquished the fiery demon. The fiery demon died on the spot. And then pursued Durvasa, who was so envious of Maharaj Amrish. Durvasa fled to Brahmaloka. He went to Brahmaloka. Brahma said, I cannot help you. Then he went to Shivaloka. Shiva said, I cannot help you. Sudarshan, I cannot do anything. And all the other higher planetary systems, but he could not protect himself from the wrath of the Sudarshan Chakra. Finally, he went to the spiritual world. He went to even Vaikuntha. And surrendered to Lord Nārāyaṇa. But Nārāyaṇa said, I cannot help you. You know, because Lord Nārāyaṇa could not excuse a person who had offended a Vaishnava. This is one more thing the Lord cannot do. He will not forgive. He cannot forgive a person who has offended a Vaishnava. The Lord also cannot do certain things. He cannot hide from his devotees. He cannot allow his devotees' promise to be broken. And he cannot excuse a person who had offended a Vaishnava. So therefore Lord Nārāyaṇa said, I also cannot help. Then he said, oh, if you also cannot help, who can help? You know, what I have now, I am doomed. Then, you know, he was very much humbled by all this. And from behind, the Sudarshan Chakra was chasing and scorching him. And to be excused from such an offense, the Lord said, to be excused from such an offense, one must submit to the Vaishnava whom he had offended. And if he agrees to forgive you, then that's the only way. Thus, Lord Nārāyaṇa advised Durvasa to return to Maharaj Amrish and beg his pardon. By the order of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Vishnu, Durvasa Muni immediately went to Maharaj Amrish and fell at his lotus feet. And Maharaj Amrish was not a great yogi, nothing. He was just an ordinary person. I mean, of course, he was a devotee. But otherwise, he did not practice any yoga, he did not have any mystic power, all that. But the Lord is there, Yogeshwara, Yatra Yogeshwara Krishna. He is the master of all mystics. His protection is there, then that devotee will become greater than any yogi because the Lord Himself will act on his behalf. Same thing happened in Bhaktivinoda Thakur's life. There was a great yogi, Bhishakisen. He was actually a powerful yogi, not simply some gymnastics and, you know, like stretching and not that kind of yogi. He was actually a yogi who had so many supernatural powers by his tantric yogic methods, and he could make anybody, you know, ill, and, you know, he could cure anybody like this. So of course that is another story, we can go into detail another time. But the Lord helped Bhaktivinoda Thakur, and that yogi was destroyed. So similarly, Durvasa Muni was completely defeated by Maharaj Amrish because the Lord helped him. Because he is like a child, you know. A child takes shelter of a big strong man can easily beat up and kill a child. But when the child is taken protection of a father who is much stronger than that strong man, then he is in trouble, you know. So similarly, Lord Vishnu is the strongest among anybody else. So a devotee takes shelter of him. So however strong this opponent may be, in the face of Vishnu he is nothing. In face of Krishna is nothing. So in that way Krishna will help the devotee. So now Maharaj Amrish, he was not proud. Durvasa, you understood who I am? No, he did not say like this. He was naturally very humble and meek. This is devotee. Even though he wins, he is not proud. You know, he in fact felt bad. On the other hand, he felt bad that Durvasa Muni had to suffer so much for 1 year. And he felt so bad that he felt himself the cause of this whole problem that has come to Durvasa Muni. And he fasted 1 year. One whole year he fasted. Because this Durvasa Muni was going 1 year to Brahmaloka, Shivaloka, and Vaikuntha Loka, and all these things happened for 1 year. And Ambarish Maharaj was just waiting there, standing in the same place without moving for 1 year. He felt so bad that I have disrespected my guest. I have put my guest into such a great inconvenience. This is how Ambarish Maharaj was thinking. He was not like, now you understood who I am. You know, he was not like that. So he, being naturally very humble and meek, felt shy and ashamed. You see, because Durvasa Muni had fallen at his feet. And thus he began to offer prayers to Sudarshan Chakra just to save Durvasa. Then he said, his prayers were like this. What is this Sudarshan Chakra? The Sudarshan Chakra is the glands of the Supreme Personality of Godhead by which he creates the entire material world. Sa Aikshata, Sa Asrajata. This is the Vedic version. The Sudarshan Chakra, which is the origin of creation and is most dear to the Lord, has thousands of spokes. This Sudarshan Chakra is the killer of the prowess of all other weapons, the killer of darkness and the manifester of the prowess of devotional service. It is the means of establishing religious principles. Paritrana sadhunam vinashaya cha duskritam. You see, Krishna said, dharma samsthapana arthaya sambhavama yuge yuge. So, he saves the devotees, he kills the demons and he establishes the religious principles. So, for killing the demons, so Narayan has chaturbhuj, roop, four hands. So, Shankha, Chakra, Gada, Padma. Shankha and Padma. The conch shell and the lotus flower is for blessing the devotees. And Chakra and Gada, their weapons to kill the demons. So, Paritrana Sadhunam, Vinashayasha Dushkritam. So, the disc is meant for Vinashayasha Dushkritam. So, in that way, the religious principles can again be established. So, it is the means of establishing religious principles and it is the killer of all religious activities. Irreligious activities. Without his mercy, the universe cannot be maintained, and therefore the Sudarshan Chakra is employed by the Supreme Personality of Godhead. When Maharaj Ambarish does pray that the Sudarshan Chakra be merciful, the Sudarshan Chakra, mind you, Sudarshan Chakra is also a person. It is not just like a lifeless disc. No, it is also a person. Just like Krishna's flute is also a person. Everything in the spiritual world is a person. Even the cloth that Krishna is wearing is a person. That's why Radharani, sometimes they are very envious of the cloth that Krishna is wearing. Oh, he has the facility for always embracing the Lord, and we don't have such facility. You know, they are envious of the cloth, and they are envious of the flute. Oh, flute, you are although you are a male, you are shamelessly drinking the lips from, I mean, the nectar from Krishna's lips. We are supposed to kiss him. Why are you doing it? Are you not ashamed of this homosexual activities? In this way, they were. Having in their transcendental madness, they were talking like this. So everything is a person. The Sudarshan Chakra is also a person. The material things are only in existence in this world. Matter is dead here. In the spiritual world, everything is living. Even the stones are living. When Maharaj Ambarish does pray that the Sudarshan Chakra be merciful, the Sudarshan Chakra, being appeased, refrained from killing Durvasa Muni and thus achieved the Sudarshan Chakra's mercy. Refrained from killing Durvasa Muni, who thus achieved the Sudarshan Chakra's mercy. By the mercy of Ambarish Maharaj, he got the Sudarshan Chakra's mercy. And like that, he got Vishnu's mercy. Durvasa Muni thus learned to give up the nasty idea of considering a Vaishnava an ordinary person, Vaishnava Jati Buddhi. Archya Vishnu Shiladhir, Gurushu Naramatir, Vaishnave Jati Buddhir. To consider the Vaishnava like, you know, from Jati, from birth. Maharaj Ambarish belonged to the Kshatriya group, and therefore Durvasa Muni considered him lower than the Brahmanas and wanted to exercise Brahmanical power against him. By this incident, everyone should learn how to stop mischievous ideas of neglecting Vaishnavas. Vaishnava should be given the topmost respect. After this incident, Maharaj Ambarish gave Durvasa Muni sumptuous food to eat, and then the king, who had been standing in the same place for 1 year without eating anything, also took prasad. Maharaj Ambarish later divided his property among his sons and went to the bank of Manasa Sarovar to execute devotional meditation. Maharaj Ambarish left his kingdom after that and gave it to his sons, and he went to the Manasa Sarovar to execute devotional meditation. In fact, after this, in this was many millions of years back, 5000 years back, again Durvasa Muni came during Mahabharata, before the war. So he went to Duryodhan's place. At that time, all the Pandavas were banished, and they were in the forest because they lost the gambling match, and they were in the forest. And Duryodhan, Durvasamuni came there, and Duryodhan made sure that Durvasamuni is not displeased, because he knows if Durvasamuni gets angry, we are finished. By his curse, all our thing will be finished. We will serve him so nicely that he will bless us. So he prepared very nice feast and everything. Not only feast, everything with like the grandest reception and everything nice for Durvasamuni. And Durvasamuni was very, very pleased with Duryodhan. So Duryodhan, what do you want? I am very pleased. I want to bless you. So Duryodhan was a rascal. So he was a very crooked man. So he knows the Pandavas were in the forest. So he said, "My dear Durvasamuni, you are such a great soul, such a great sadhu. I actually am very much hurt to know that, you know, my cousins, the Pandavas, are suffering greatly in the forest. So as you have blessed me, my wish is that you also go and bless them. So that is what I want." Then Durvasamuni, "Oh, this is very nice of you. You know, you have such great feeling for your cousins." So he went. And Durvasamuni, when he came, he did not come alone. He came with 60,000 disciples. 60,000 disciples. So, and Duryodhan took very nice care of everybody and fully, you know, received them properly. So then he said, "As you have taken, you know, come here, please also bless the Pandavas so that their miseries will be reduced a bit." Then Durvasamuni, "Yes, yes, I will do that. I will do that. Very nice of you, you know, the very good boy." Then he went. Duryodhan was like laughing. These Pandavas are going to get it now, because what they will, 60,000 people he is coming with, and then what they will cook in the forest for him, definitely he is going to be angry with them and he will curse them, and that's it. They will be even in more trouble. This is going to be fun to watch. So Durvasamuni went to the forest. Duryodhan was anxiously waiting for the news what will happen. So Durvasamuni went, and he went to the hut where the Pandavas were there. And then Yudhishthir Maharaj and all the five Pandavas and Draupadi were there. So the Yudhishthir Maharaj said, my dear sadhu, oh, please take your bath in the river with all of your disciples, and we will prepare a nice feast for you, prasadam for you. Please, you go and come. So we will prepare all arrangements. So, and the Pandavas have a pot called Akshayapatra. Akshayapatra. Akshayapatra means pot. Akshaya means unlimited. So it is a pot given by Surya, the sun god, that it is a very special pot. So during the Vanavas, or during the forest, you know, dwelling days, you know, during the exile, they were in the forest, so it is very difficult to cook and everything. So they were awarded this pot, and in that pot, as long as Draupadi does not eat for the day, she can bring as many dishes out of that pot as possible. Whatever they want will come out of the pot. Just by desiring, it will come out of the pot. But if for that day Draupadi has eaten, that's it. It will not work. Again, next day only. So Yudhishthir Maharaj was very confident of serving all the 60,001, Durvasamuni and his 60,000 disciples. He was very confident of serving them because he had the Akshayapatra. So he said, "Draupadi, please prepare all the foodstuff for them. We can prepare lavish prasadam for the sadhus." Then Draupadi said, "Oh, how is this possible now? I have eaten everything." Then Yudhishthir Maharaj was like, "Oh, now how to serve this Durvasamuni?" They are devotees, so they just thought of Krishna. "Krishna, only you can help." And Krishna, although he was somewhere in Dwaraka, immediately appeared. And in the forest, from where? He has appeared. He is everywhere. Antar Bahira Vasthitam. He is in every molecule, in everybody's heart. So he just appeared. So he appeared. Then he said, "Don't worry." Then he, "Give me the Akshayapatra." Then he took the pot. And in the pot, Draupadi cleaned it, but she could not clean it properly. By the Lord's arrangement, she did not clean it properly. There was one leaf of shak. Shak means the spinach. Little bit was there, stuck to the pot. He just took that and ate it. He said, that's it, that's enough. Then he gave the pot back and he left. So what happened? So when Krishna ate, all Durvasa Muni along with his 60,000 disciples in the water, in the river, big confluence, big, you know, like as if it was a Kumbh Mela, it was like that. 60,000 people, you know, at once. So all of them suddenly felt very full in their stomach, like as if they cannot even eat one thing. And Durvasa Muni said, let us go from here. We cannot go to Yudhishthira Maharaj, because if we go there, and he is a very great Vaishnava, Lord Krishna is very close to him. I already got my back burnt once with Sudarshan Chakra because of Ambarish Maharaj. I don't want to get burnt again. I know what is the power of Vaishnava. We cannot offend him. If we go there and then if he serves it, and if we don't eat, then he will be offended. And then again Sudarshan Chakra will come after me. We will just go away from here. Quietly we will go away. Durvasa Muni along with his disciples went away. And then Yudhishthira Maharaj was saved. You know, Yudhishthira Maharaj waiting, what happened? And Krishna said, he will not come. He has eaten. So like this. So Durvasa Muni learnt his lesson of not offending Vaishnavas, and he did not repeat the mistake with Yudhishthira Maharaj and all the five Pandavas who are very great devotees of the Lord. So we have digressed quite a bit, but we'll come back. So this is the story of Ambarish Maharaj. So we have finished the story part of it. Now, next part. Some excerpts from Srila Prabhupada's books and his teachings, sometimes his letters also, I think. So what Prabhupada said about Ekadasi, and you know, what are the basic understanding? There are many quotations. Actually, Haribhakti Vilas, Sanatana Goswami, has, in fact, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu asked him to write everything in detail about everything about devotional service, and he also particularly mentioned about Ekadasi also. So there are so many nice verses in Haribhakti Vilas about Ekadasi and all. Even those rules have been relaxed by Prabhupada quite a bit, and we were only given very little of it. So once somebody asked Prabhupada, should we chant 25 rounds of Hare Krishna on Ekadasi? Then Prabhupada said, why just 25 rounds? You should chant as many as possible. Real Ekadasi means fasting and chanting and no other business. When one observes fasting, the chanting becomes easier. When one observes fasting, the chanting becomes easier. So on the Ekadasi, other business can be suspended as far as possible unless there is some urgent business. Srila Prabhupada letter to Jadurani, 9th July 1971. So of course, it has become a practice of Hare Krishna devotees to chant 25 rounds on Ekadasi. Although Srila Prabhupada never explicitly mentioned it, but because it is always good to do more, so the devotees usually do 25 rounds minimum. Some people do more also. But the whole point is to chant, to do service, you know, just engage in Krishna service and minimize the bodily demands. This is about food. I have duly received the bananas you sent, and you can send me these dried bananas, tons and tons. Dried bananas, so not the fruit bananas, the vegetable banana. So dried, you can send me these dried bananas, tons and tons. It is very useful and can be nicely used for our Ekadashi foodstuffs. After drying the bananas, you can make powder just like flour, and out of this you can prepare puris, halwa, pakoras and other fruit products. Srila Prabhupada to Govindadasi, October 27, 1969. So Ekadashi foodstuffs. So actually we are now doing this kind of thing, drying all the, we have gotten a, what is that, dehydrator. We can't put it under the sun here, but we have a dehydrator which is doing that. We are drying all the fruits and, you know, different vegetables sometimes. So it is actually turning out very nice, and it can be kept for very long, you know. So anyway, going forward, Ekadasi is observed for increasing the strength of devotion. In fact, Bhaktivinoda Thakur also has sung, Madhavati thi bhakti janani. I forget the second line. So, Madhava Tithi Bhakti Janani. That one line is actually enough. Madhava Tithi Bhakti Janani. So, Madhava Tithi means this Ekadashi and Janmashtami, all these appearance days. This is Bhakti Janani, the mother of devotion. Srila Jiva Goswami, this is from the purport of Canto 7, Chapter 14, Texts 20-23 in the purport. Srila Jiva Goswami has given quotations from many Shastras stating that the Shraddha ceremony of oblations to the forefathers should not be performed on Ekadashi Tithi. Shraddha ceremony means for the departed soul. It should not be performed on Ekadashi Tithi. When the Tithi of the death anniversary falls on the Ekadashi day, the Shraddha ceremony should be held not on Ekadashi but on the next day on Dwadashi. In the Brahma Vaivarta Purana it is said, Ye Kurvanti Mahipala Shraddham Chaikadashi Dine Trayaste Narakam Yanti Data Bhoktacha Prerakaha. If one performs the Shraddha ceremony of oblations to the forefathers on the Ekadashi Tithi, then the performer, the forefathers for whom the Shraddha is observed, and the Purohit or the family priest who encourages the ceremony all go to hell. So, another. Chaitanya Charitamrita Adilila, Chapter 15, Text 9, Translation and Purport. So, translation. His mother replied, this is Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's mother, because he asked her to follow the Ekadashi Vrata. His mother replied, My dear son, I will give you whatever you ask. Then the Lord said, My dear mother, please do not eat grains on the Ekadashi day. From the very beginning of his childhood life, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu introduced the system of observing a fast on the Ekadashi day. In the Bhakti Sandarbha by Srila Jiva Goswami, there is a quotation from the Skanda Purana admonishing that a person who eats grains on Ekadashi becomes a murderer of his mother, father, brother and a spiritual master, and even if he is elevated to a Vaikuntha planet, he falls down. On Ekadashi, everything is cooked for Vishnu, including regular grains and dal, but it is enjoined that a Vaishnava should not even take Vishnu Prasadam on Ekadashi. It is said that a Vaishnava does not accept anything eatable that is not offered to Lord Vishnu, but on Ekadashi, a Vaishnava should not touch even Mahaprasadam offered to Vishnu, although such Prasadam may be kept for being eaten the next day. It is strictly forbidden for one to accept any kind of grain on Ekadashi, even if it is offered to Lord Vishnu. And in the next verse, Mother Sachi said, Sachi Devi is the mother of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. You have spoken very nicely, I shall not eat grains on Ekadashi. From that day she began to observe fasting on Ekadashi. So, why she did not fast before? So, this is explained in the purport. It is a prejudice among Smartha Brahmanas that a widow must observe fasting on Ekadashi, but a woman who is Sadhava, who has her husband, should not fast on Ekadashi. It appears that before Lord Chaitanya's request, Sachimata, being Sadhava, not Vidhava. Vidhava means widow. Sadhava means with husband, whose husband has not passed away. Sachimata, being Sadhava, was not observing Ekadashi. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, however, introduced a system that a woman, even if not a widow, must observe the Ekadashi day and must not touch any kind of grains, even those offered to deity of Vishnu. So, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu changed the system that even whether she is Sadhava or Vidhava, it doesn't matter, every woman has to follow the Ekadashi. You should recommend the avoidance, this is actually Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's instructions to Sanatana Goswami on how to direct the devotees about all kinds of devotional practices, and these instructions of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu later manifested as Sanatana Goswami's book, which is Haribhakti Vilas. So, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is giving the direction. You should recommend the avoidance of mixed Ekadashi and the performance of pure Ekadashi. This is again that Mahadvadashi principle. You should recommend the avoidance of mixed Ekadashi, which is not Shuddha Ekadashi. Recommend the avoidance of it. So, on the Mahadvadashi, the thing is taken. So, you should also describe the fault in not observing Ekadashi. One should be very careful as far as these items are concerned. If one is not careful, one will be negligent in executing devotional service. So, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu stressed this principle to Sanatana Goswami. So, these are some of the quotations. There are so many quotations, but we are just going brief, and basically, there are other quotations which echo the same things that are already said. Now the next section. Mahadvadasi. Now what is this Mahadvadasi? Why do we not sometimes fast on Ekadasi? So that is, this explanation is given. Some devotees also asked me these things. Why do we sometimes fast on a Dvadasi and not Ekadasi? So again, I quoted the same thing here. The Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's instruction to Sanatana Goswami. You should recommend, this is from Chaitanya Charitamrita, Madhya Lila, chapter 24, text 342. You should recommend the avoidance of mixed Ekadashi and the performance of pure Ekadashi. You should also describe the fault in not observing Ekadashi. One should be very careful as far as these items are concerned. If one is not careful, one will be negligent in executing devotional service. And this article, the following article, was written by one devotee. His name will be given in the, I think, Manonath Das. Manonath Prabhu, who is Prabhupada's disciple. So now this is the article actually. Mahadvadashi. Sometimes due to the manner in which Ekadashi Tithi and the Dvadashi Tithis are positioned in relation to the sunrise, there are 8 different cases. The Vrata is observed on the Dvadashi and the fast is broken the next day, the Trayodashi. Such a fast is called a Mahadvadashi to distinguish it from a regular Dvadashi, which is the day to break the Ekadashi fast. So the moonrise and the sunrise are not at the same time. So our calendar is according to lunar calendar. So the sun calendar, you know, what tithi falls at the sunrise, that determines the tithi for the day. And then, you know, that 22 hours of cycle, if the Dvadashi enters before 22 hours, then before sunrise it enters already. So these things actually make some... So because of this, there are 8 different cases like that, which can be grouped into 4. So you know, for each case, there will be 2 subsets. So anyway, it's very technical. Those who know astrology, even I do not know the exact nitty-gritty of all this. But those who know astrology and are more conversant with that science, they will be able to tell everything very, very clearly. But I'm just repeating whatever I have read. Śrīla Prabhupāda, what you said about Dvadashi. So regarding your questions about the calendar almanac, so how to do Vaishnava calendar and all that, so he was giving directions. Hera Panchami is correct, 9th July 1970. Then second point, when there is an important Dvadashi, the Ekadashi fasting is transferred on the Dvadashi and this is called Mahadvadashi. The 26th October 1970 is actually Dvadashi, so the fasting is observed together, or Ekadashi fasting is disregarded. And the Dvadashi, Mahadvadashi fasting is taken as important. This is his letter to Pradyumna, Los Angeles, 29th April 1970. This Pradyumna Prabhu was very expert in Sanskrit and all. So he used to understand all these things. So Mahadvadashi, if Mahadvadashi is in force, fasting is prohibited on the Ekadashi, but the observance is done on the Dvadashi. Why? As already said, there may be several reasons, amongst which there are, one, if Ekadashi begins after sunrise and ends before sunrise the next day, you see, if Ekadashi begins after sunrise and ends before the sunrise the next day, it is considered lost, too short, thus not full and impure. And therefore, the next day is called Unmilani Mahadvadashi. So each of the Mahadvadashi also has names. So, Unmilani Mahadvadashi, and the Ekadashi is too short. That is one reason why Mahadvadashi will come. So, another reason, if Dvadashi begins after sunrise, so Ekadashi is alright, but Dvadashi begins after sunrise and ends before sunrise on the next day, Trayodashi, it is also lost and it is to be observed as Trisprisha Mahadvadashi. On that day, Mahadvadashi, I mean, the Ekadashi fasting has to be followed on the Dvadashi day. Although Ekadashi is alright, but the Dvadashi is lost. So, then this is called Trisprisha Mahadvadashi. Actually, when I prepare the calendar every year, you know, we have a temple calendar. So, I am the one who prepare the dates and everything. I see the Vaishnava calendar and I always see these words, Trisprisha Mahadvadashi and Vyanjali Mahadvadashi, Pakshavardhina Mahadvadashi. I never understood what it was. Now I understand to an extent, not entirely, but at least now I get an idea of what it is. So, if Dvadasi falls on the sunrise 2 days in a row, the first Dvadasi becomes Vyanjali Mahadvadasi. So again, the Dvadasi. Ekadashi may be alright again, but it won't be alright because if 2 days the Dvadasi is on sunrise, that means Ekadashi is already before. It already ended before the sunrise. So anyway, so here the consideration is of Dvadasi, not Ekadashi. So the if Dvadasi falls on sunrise 2 days in a row, the first Dvadasi becomes Vyanjali Mahadvadasi. So again, the Ekadashi fasting is done on that Mahadvadasi. And fourth point, when the following Amavasya, so Ekadashi, Dvadasi, all are alright, but the following Amavasya or Purnima falls on sunrise 2 days in a row, preceding the Dvadasi, sorry, when the following Amavasya or Purnima falls on sunrise 2 days in a row, the preceding Dvadasi becomes Pakshavardhini Mahadvadasi, Paksha-based. So, Paksha-based Mahadvadasi. So, it is not exactly, the Ekadashi is pure, but actually it's mixed. So, but it is not, it is full, Dvadasi also is full, but the Amavasya and Purnima, they happen for two consecutive sunrises. Then that is called Pakshavardhini. Then that Dvadashi has to be followed, not the Ekadashi. So it's called Pakshavardhini Mahadvadashi. So there's the categories of Mahadvadashis. This was contributed by Manonath Prabhu, who is Prabhupada's disciple. So that is a good information. So we are indebted to him. So in this way, this is about Mahadvadashi. And coming to the final part, which is actually quite lengthy, but I think we will just do it because we will just do it one shot. This is about the food. What we should and should not eat on Ekadashi. Because after all, this is what devotees actually want to know. But actually we should also know that Ekadashi is not about what we cannot eat, what we should not eat. Am I eating something? It's all not about eating at all. If we are always concentrating on what to eat and what not to eat, then we have missed the total point of Ekadashi, which is to actually engage in devotional service of Krishna. But again, there are rules on what you can and cannot eat. And actually, it has been some grey areas also. Some things are not as clear. So, this article is taken from a Facebook post, but this post is also not completely authentic. There is some things which are not correct. And in the comments of this post, which I did not include here, there has been some evidences given by Prabhupada's disciple where in this article, for example, there is one place he says mustard seeds can be eaten. But then in the comments, Prabhupada's disciples, they reply that no, this devotee, he was with Prabhupada and he is saying here that Prabhupada did not use mustard seeds. So there is this kind of thing. So we don't use mustard and sesame seeds. Although in one classification it may be considered a grain, but in other classification it is considered a seed and not a grain. So there are so many confusions in what you can eat and cannot eat. The best way to avoid all these troubles is to not eat anything. But it's not possible for everybody. And therefore, fruits, if you take fruits and water, you'll be just fine. You know, but if we want to really explore what can and cannot be eaten, then, you know, these are all the instructions. And sometimes, especially when we are receiving devotees who are coming from overseas or something like that, and they are coming on an Ekadashi, we have to offer them something, right? So it is good to know also what are things. And Prabhupada also was not, he said, you see, give me that banana, dried banana, and we can make a flour, we can make pakoras and all these things. So Prabhupada did not like really advocate complete nirjal fast. Although, if you do nirjal fast, it is good. It is the strictest way, the gold standard of following Ekadashi. But at the same time, Srila Prabhupada knew that we are not, and he himself did not follow like that as well. So it is not a must. So we should follow what Srila Prabhupada has given us. If we can follow more, fine, but minimum we should follow. So anyway, with that in mind, let's quickly try to read this. it will take a while, but and it is not properly formatted as well. The paragraphs are all not proper, so it'll be a little confusing to see the wordings, but we'll just bear with it and go on. So this is how he starts the article. There has been a lot of confusion over the years about what to eat and what not to eat on Ekadashi. Today we are no nearer to what is permissible and or not on Ekadashi, as there are many ways to observe Ekadashi and there is no definitive guide book or law book on it. Some practitioners have a more strict set of guidelines regarding the individual ingredients, so such a list would be simultaneously helpful and controversial. Since Ekadashi these days and since more than just Hare Krishna devotees observe Ekadashi these days, and since the borders have been blurred for some, this has been the cause of confusion. We shall on our website go out on a limb and publicly announce to the world that this is what you can and can't consume on Ekadashi. We are pursuing this matter rather seriously because certain Hindu organizations don't want to publicly state what can and what can't be consumed on this most holiest of days due to the fact that lots of foods are still grey areas. The gold standard would be to fast on Ekadashi without consuming a drop of water and remain awake for the night. So that is nirjala. Jala means water. Nirjala means without even water. Fasting without even water. Nirjala fast. Some of our devotees here also do that. I did it in the past for some, but I don't at the moment. Srila Prabhupada saw the impracticality of this in the modern age and advised that we abstain from the grains and beans on this day and increase our devotional service with additional chanting. This being said, we advocate the standard set by Srila Prabhupada. This is not to say that there are no other standards out there, some more and others less stringent. We do not wish to argue the merits of the various approaches, but provide this information as a guide to allow individuals to decide which option to exercise. We feel there is a lot of misconceptions about Ekadashi. When you read the kathas on Ekadashi, the heroes and the characters of the kathas derive enormous benefit from accidentally or unconsciously observing this holy vrat or fast. If you receive that kind of punya karma, blessings, merits, mercy, from unconsciously fasting, surely people who knowingly attempt the vrat can't be worse off. Everyone needs to start somewhere. You can't start observing every Ekadashi as nirjala. The Ekadashi fast that comes in June where no water is consumed immediately. That means you can't start observing every Ekadashi as nirjala immediately. It often takes time and sometimes people are never able to follow it up. But rather than Ekadashi being projected as impossible to observe, we should make clear the basics and urge individuals to perform the Ekadashi fast correctly. Many websites seem to simply demoralize individuals by publishing long lists of prohibited foods. I am better than you, na type of syndrome. This is so unfortunate that when we think after reading about the benefits of Ekadashi on the day, so many benefits are bestowed upon the individual, but apparently eating a brinjal eggplant, which is not a grain and not a meat derivative, including onion, garlic at all, is catastrophic. Grains must be avoided on Ekadashi as they have a detrimental effect on our body. On Ekadashi, with regards to the moon, it plays havoc with our body. The water in the sea and so many other things are affected by the position of the moon. Grain food eaten on Ekadashi retains water. And since the moon plays such havoc with water, it affects our health adversely. So this is medical aspect of Ekadashi. So the essence of this fast is to decrease eating and sleeping so that one can spend as much time as possible on hearing, chanting and remembering Sri Krishna. There are some practitioners whose diet on Ekadashi are much more strict than others. Those who fully observe this fast do not eat, drink or sleep on this day. Others consume fruits and milk and spend more time being absorbed in chanting the Lord's names and reading our scriptures. To increase the austerity means to increase the benefit of this fast. So some follow a stricter regime, but one should not impose it on anyone else. That's not cool. I mean, his language is a bit... So we can quote so many do's and don'ts yet. Yet Srila Prabhupada gave us a simpler and easier formula for observing Ekadashi. Srila Prabhupada, understanding the inadequacies of the present day society, did not insist on a very strict following of Ekadashi, other than refraining from mainly rice, dal and beans, expecting devotees to increase their hearing and chanting of the Lord's names and pastimes. There is a variety of prohibited vegetables, carrot, eggplant, broccoli, etc. mentioned in our scriptures, especially the Kurma Puran. But Srila Prabhupada never enforced this rule nor followed it himself. Thus, it is acceptable on Ekadashi for devotees to consume any vegetable while refraining from mainly rice, bean and dal. A complete fast even from water was not expected by Srila Prabhupada or his followers. Still, if one is able to perform this austerity with increased hearing and chanting, it was very much appreciated by Srila Prabhupada. In India, most people who fast on this day refrain from a range of vegetables including tomatoes, cauliflower, eggplant, lady fingers, okra or bindi, and leafy vegetables, and do not use any spices except pepper, rock salt and cumin, jeera. Srila Prabhupada specified food grains and beans, pulses as foods that must be avoided on Ekadashi. One may use spices for cooking. You should not use powdered asafoetida, hing, since it generally contains grains. The whole asafoetida, hing, which is black in color, is used instead. All grains, pulses and beans, either whole or ground into flour, rice, wheat, chickpeas, besan flour, soya, barley, millet, rye, all dals and dried beans, and anything that contains these ingredients like papadams, tofu, pasta, grain beverages, vegetables such as green beans, corn, peas. Read below what we say about this, about peas, later it will come. Oils made from grains like corn oil, soya oil and products that may have been fried in these. Please note that snacks fried in vegetable oil may have been fried in the oils listed above. What about sunflower oil? It is sunflower, so that is a seed and not a grain, but you can use pure butter ghee simply because we cannot vouch for the sanctity of the refining process for the oil. One can also use pure unsalted butter. That is why I suggest, this is his suggestion, that people, I think his name is Alok Kumar, his Facebook name was Alok Kumar, maybe he has an initiated name, I do not know, maybe. One can also use pure unsalted butter. That is why I suggest that people purchase unsalted butter just for that day. You can purchase a little tub of ghee for under 30 rupees. This is an Indian context. And that is enough for a few Ekadashi preps. Personally, this is what I do on Ekadashi, or else I use extra virgin olive oil. Do not use any cooking ingredients that might be mixed with grains, such as ghee that has been used to fry puris. That means that's why we change the oil. So, if some ghee in which puris were fried, we won't use that same ghee or oil to fry maybe Ekadashi pakoras or something like that for Ekadashi. No. If the grains have touched the oil somehow or other, that oil cannot be used for Ekadashi. Or spices touched by hands dusted with flour. That means, like turmeric powder or chili powder or anything which, you know, when we use the powder maybe on a normal day, maybe some of the dust of flour, it may go there, and then that kind of powder cannot be used. It has to be pure. And even salt, sometimes we put salt like that, and then maybe we have touched some grains, and then maybe chapati dough we did, and then we put the salt into some sabji. So that salt cannot be used on Ekadashi. We have to open a new packet of salt or something like that. So these things have to be followed. There is absolutely no doubt about what is not permissible to eat on Ekadashi, anna, grains. However, it is how you translate this word that makes the difference. Srila Prabhupada said fruits, roots, nuts, milk. If you stick to these types of foods, you should be fine. Of course, the sure way is to fast completely. Water, of course, can be taken, except if you wish to do nirjala fast. One who is very strictly observing Ekadashi should avoid all spices except pepper, rock salt and cumin. Individuals may observe these rules if they choose, either making their own arrangements for cooking on Ekadashi, eating uncooked foods such as fruits, or observing a full fast. this is a heading for the next line, I think. So, just a second. Okay. Mahaprasad on Ekadashi. On Ekadashi, strict followers of Vaishnava regulations avoid eating any Mahaprasad from an offering that includes grains. The Shastra explains that the Papa Purusha, sin personified, takes shelter in grains on Ekadashi, and therefore we avoid grains at all costs on the day, not even risking taking non-grain preparations of Mahaprasad from an offering plate containing grains. So, this is called Anukalpa. Anukalpa means, sorry, my leg is a little bit hurting. So, Anukalpa means non-grain prasadam. But when we are offering to Krishna, we should offer full, because the sin cannot touch Krishna or Vishnu. So, he does not need to follow this. But we cook for him because we also need to eat. But there are extra items like chapatis and rice which are cooked for Krishna but not eaten by devotees. But the other items which are cooked that can be eaten for Ekadashi, those are cooked so that devotees can eat. Ekadashi Mahaprasad should be stored until the next day. If that is not possible, it can be distributed to persons not strictly following Vaishnava regulations or to animals. In fact, Mahaprasad maintains its purity on Ekadashi despite the presence of Papa Purusha, and therefore it will purify anyone who eats it. Nevertheless, the followers of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, being strict followers of the Vaishnava regulations, avoid Mahaprasad on that day because their strict sadhana will be hampered by the presence of the Papa Purusha. From an Ayurvedic perspective, even if, especially if one is fasting entirely or even just taking water, the malas, stools absorb the toxins in the body when fasting. So on the day the fast is broken, it is good to And it is a good idea to take a gentle laxative consisting of 50-50 warm milk and water with some rock candy to sweeten it. Generally, 4 to 5 cups are drunk up to 7, and within half an hour to an hour one will expel the malas. After this, at lunchtime one takes one's meal of prasadam. Anyway, we don't really strictly follow this, but if you want to be an Ayurvedic hero, then you can follow this. One second, I was going somewhere else. Okay. So, once again, these are the food, spices, etc. you can and can't have on Ekadashi. This is the following. One shouldn't get started about seeds because bananas have seeds, and the potato and tomato that everyone eats is also a seed. The best principle is articulated below. One must abstain from all types of grains and beans, including derivatives and anything containing grains and beans. This is clearly articulated and not in question. Also, for non-vegetarians, clearly the additional restrictions of no meat, onion and garlic will be relevant. Beyond that, we do not see any value in adding to a list of restrictions. But we did anyway. The most holy of days should not be spent in trying to sidestep a minefield of taboo foods, which frankly is the impression many are left with constantly. Ekadashi means always, you know, worrying what I can eat today, what I cannot eat, or worrying about eating only. No, it's not at all about that. So that is what he's trying to say. Trying to sidestep a minefield of taboo foods. For most Ekadashi seems to be, what do I avoid today, instead of the increase my thoughts of Lord Krishna day, you know. All ingredients used on non-Ekadashi days must not be used on Ekadashi, since the possibility exists that grains may have mixed into it. It is best to keep separate containers for spices, butter, sugar, etc. that will be used on Ekadashi. Masalas and spice mixes purchased from stores are known to sometimes contain grains, onion and garlic. It is thus best to make one's own masalas, which we have provided below. He did not provide it, but in another article in their website. What is the technical difference between a grain and a seed? Technically, a grain is a fruit with a single seed fused, while a seed is an ovule, think egg, with an embryo enclosed within. In the case of wheat, the flour we derive is mainly the ground up fruit part of the grain, the wheat germ being the seed part fused within the grain. In the case of, for instance, the millet, the ovule part of the seed is so meaty, comparatively speaking, it has properties reminiscent of the fruit part of grains, and in culinary terms we therefore treat them similarly to a grain. Some grain like, see, these are very, what is a grain and what is a seed is very intricate. Sometimes therefore there is confusion on what to follow, what not to follow. Sometimes they are classified as one, sometimes they are classified as another. So that's why different people have different opinions about what can or cannot be eaten. But we will just follow what Prabhupada usually generally gave us and we will just get ahead with our Ekadashi. So anyway, here it is. Some grain-like seeds are used as grains like, quinoa, amaranth, buckwheat and millet. Wheat, rice, spelt, which is another form of wheat, and oats are clear-cut grains. Sesame, mustard and pumpkin seeds are, well, seeds, but these all sprout if you put them in water. So, maybe it's a seed, but actually it is sometimes considered as grain. So, in seeds like peas and pea-likes, parts of the seed's embryo, the food storage ones allow the embryonic part to push up to reach the surface when planted and germinated, or when the seeds or peas are dried. So, mealy in their properties, we can grind them up to produce flour, like chickpea, gram flour for instance. That is a substance that in culinary items reminds us of the properties of grain flour, and so we treat them as though they were actually ground up grains. So in other words, peas are considered grains in that way. Ingredients that one can consume on Ekadashi. Clean salt, meaning salt that only used on Ekadashi and not on any other day. In fact, one devotee actually told me that it is best not to use even sea salt, because sea salt, you know, in the sea there are fishes and all that. Even if you refine them, there is fishes. So they say Himalayan salt is best because it's rock salt, you know. It's not like the from the sea salt. But then again, everywhere there are living entities, right? Even on the mountains. Sarvagata sthanur, Bhagavad Gita says. So anyway, Prabhupada did not really like say must, but the devotees were saying that it is better to use Himalayan salt because we don't have to deal with fish or whatever is there in the water. But then again, when it is followed strictly, they only use that rock salt. They don't even use in the temples the sea salt also. So, but there's not been such a clear order from Srila Prabhupada. So we use, even he said once, sugar, you know, the white sugar especially, the devotees have said, you know, in the preparation of the sugar, you know, sometimes the bones of cows are enough, you know, used to make it white or something like that, whiten it. I don't know what the process is, but they said this, and Prabhupada said, what to do, you know, Kali Yuga, everything is contaminated, what we can do, you know, we can never find a pure ingredient. So we will do what is practically possible and what Srila Prabhupada told us, and that much we will follow. So clean salt, clean sugar, meaning sugar that only used on Ekadashi and not on any other day. Clean oil, meaning oil that only used on Ekadashi and not on any other day. So if there is a container or a wok full of oil that has been used for another day, the previous day, so that oil has to be taken out and the container fully washed completely so that no grain is there, and then put new oil and then boil in that one. Boil or fry. Pure unsalted butter, ghee, oil, except those made from grains like corn oil or soy oil cannot be used. Use oils like helios oil made with sunflower seeds, coconut oil, peanut oil, spices like turmeric ground from raw form, hing in its raw form, not the powdered one. They use grains, they mix grains in it. Cinnamon sticks, because if you don't add grains to hing, I mean the grains, powder, it will stick. I heard it is from a sap of a tree. Actually, I do not know what hing was until one devotee told me it's from a sap of a tree. So, anyway, so it usually sticks, it seems, if it is not added with grain powder. So, that's why grain is added. So, usually don't use the powdered one. Get in its raw form. Honestly, I've never seen hing in its raw form. Thanks to our urban culture, we're not completely disconnected from nature. That's the way things are now. So, cinnamon sticks, bay leaves, ground or whole pepper, tamarind, cardamom, elachi, this can be used, all this can be used. Nutmeg, cloves, ginger, chilies, green or dried red, curry leaves, mint, which is pudina, coriander, dhania or cilantro, thyme, saffron, basil, parsley, paprika. This basil is not the tulsi, it is the Italian basil, you know, that spice. Paprika, nigella seeds, poppy seeds, and then potatoes, mass yogurt, condensed milk, cottage cheese, that means paneer. And about this paneer, if you are making it from the milk powder has this ingredient called soya lecithin, which is a derivative of soya. It is I don't know for what exactly they use it. I did not study that. Maybe there's a good reason why soya lecithin. I don't know what lecithin is actually. You can do a research on Google. What is soya lecithin? So that is usually involved in in milk powder. So if you're making paneer from milk powder, then you can't use that paneer on Ekadasi. Even the UHT processed milk also has this. Only the fresh milk doesn't have it. So you have to buy fresh milk and make paneer if you want to make paneer. Only that paneer can be used for Ekadasi. If you have cows and a farm, best. I mean, you just take the milk from the cows and make paneer. You don't have to worry about anything. But if you want to buy these packet ones, which I presume many of us are going to do, because we're in the cities at the moment, so we have to take into consideration all these things. And fresh cream, sour cream. In other places, sour cream, Prabhupada said, is not, you know, to be taken. So there are some this kind of discrepancies, you know, regarding yesterday we about double boiled rice, parboiled rice. So I asked Prabhu, he was so busy today, he could not take it out, but he did not know where he saw it. He showed us, I remember seeing that, where he even mentioned that Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur also allowed double boiled rice in his temples and Prabhupada. So he showed something like this, so he also recollected that, but he couldn't find where he saw. So we will again look into it and get back to you on that one, on the double boiled rice. So again, so coming back here, yogurt, again yogurt also, please take note that if it is prepared with milk which is UHT processed, it will contain that soya lecithin. So make yogurt with fresh milk, and that can be used. Rooibos tea, I don't know what that is. Green tea, I don't know why is green tea here. It shouldn't even be consumed by even whether Ekadasi or not Ekadasi. I don't know why is even here. This is nonsense. So sometimes, so therefore, I'm saying this article is not completely authentic. There's some mistake. Although for the most part, they have good information. It has good information. Some information is completely off. Like, what is this green tea doing here? I mean, this is straight up intoxication. And if on Ekadasi you take intoxication, well and good, you know. It's worse than having intoxication on non-Ekadasi days. So forget that, I have deleted it. So peppers, green bananas, paneer, again from paneer from fresh milk, and yogurt from fresh milk. Coconut, desiccated coconut, raisins, jaggery, pista, means pistachio, badam, means almonds, cashew nut, cucumber, karela, which is bitter melon, poppy seeds. For some, poppy seeds is a, you know, shady thing. It's like a drug. But actually, in Indian cooking, there are poppy seeds used for kheer and all this. Makes very tasteful. But it's not like an intoxicant. If you take more of it, of course it is. But I don't know much about poppy seeds actually. But it is there as cooking ingredient. And pumpkin seeds, rose water, lemon juice, lemons, peanuts, cabbage, butternut, gem squash, lettuce, all kinds of fruits. Masala, if you make your own masala, that's fine, but I would not recommend purchasing it from shops as these have powdered grains in it. So this is another consideration. The composition of masala differs regionally with wide varieties across India. Some common ingredients in this Deepika's Ekadashi's masala, actually he has a company called Deepika's Masalas or something like this. So they also sell, he's a devotee and who has his business, Deepika's Masalas and like that. So they have Ekadashi Masalas which they make. So that's how he's promoting his brand. But I mean, for devotees who want, if they are in India, they can maybe look up Deepika's Ekadashi Masala. Our black and white peppercorns, dried red chili peppers, ginger powder, curry leaves, sesame seeds, mustard seeds. So you see, Deepika's Ekadashi Masala, are common ingredients in this masala are these, you know, mustard seeds, sesame seeds. So this again, he says mustard seeds and sesame seeds can be used because they are actually seeds, they are not grains. But then again, in the Navadhanya there is sesame also included, which considers, which makes it grain again. So, and actually one person who has quoted, one devotee called Smarahari Prabhu, who was a servant, personal servant of Prabhupada at one point of time. So he said, Prabhupada particularly said, don't use sesame and mustard seeds. But he says, Prabhupada used mustard seeds. Some say Prabhupada used, some say Prabhupada did not use. So we have to actually get to what actually Prabhupada said, because there can be many stories like Prabhupada said this, Prabhupada said that, but there has to be like really where Prabhupada said what, to who, all this, and whether it is recorded or not, everything has to be. So, but we don't eat, we don't use mustard seeds and sesame seeds. That's what we have always been understood. We have always understood like that. So, for all of you watching, I definitely won't recommend Deepika's Ekadashi Masala, because they contain sesame seeds and mustard seeds. I mean, he did an advertisement, but you know, it backfired kind of. So we'll go further. Ground turmeric from turmeric stick, sonf, which is fennel, fennel seeds, cloves, long pepper, pepali, jeera, cinnamon, ilachi, nutmeg, star anise, and dhania seeds, I mean coriander seeds. Of course, some may add other non-grain ingredients. And talking about this, there is something, we used to use varai, which is called moria. We have stopped using that. We have always been using that before, but we have stopped because they say it is also good for Ekadashi. But recently some article came up, says it's grain, so we stopped using that. And Sabudana, some people have some apprehensions about Sabudana because it's prepared unclean or something like that. But well, there are so many recipes of devotees, Prabhupada's disciples, with Sabudana. So at this point of time, we just use Sabudana. So unless, I don't know, if something very compelling comes up, we're going to use Sabudana still. Yeah, like that, there are some confusions about that. Of course, some may add other non-grain ingredients. Varying combinations of these and other spices are used in regional variants of masala, none of which is considered more authentic than another. Chili powder, if you make your own chili powder, that's fine, but I would not recommend purchasing it from shops as they have powdered grains in it. Chili powder is a generic name for any powdered spice mix composed chiefly of chili peppers, most commonly either red peppers or cayenne peppers, which are both of the species capsicum annuum. Well, you can definitely see that I'm not a cook or a chef. I don't know many of these names. It can be made from virtually any hot pepper, including ancho, cayenne, jalapeno, New Mexico and pachila chilies. Some common ingredients in this Deepika's Ekadashi chili powder is pure powdered chilies, cayenne, jeera, oregano, salt, black pepper, cinnamon, cloves, coriander, nutmeg and turmeric. Of course, some may add other non-grain ingredients. Varying combinations of these and other spices are used in regional variants of chili powder, none of which is considered more authentic than another. Methi seeds, fenugreek comes from the Trigonella foenum gracum family, plant in the family Fabaceae, I don't know how you want to pronounce that, and is a seed from the plant. Jeera is derived from the flower and is not a bean or pod. ISKCON's Juhu temple serves kadi with jeera. Kurmada says, I have always understood jeera to be absolutely fine on Ekadasi. The whole seeds, not the powder, not ground by yourself. Jeera is a dried seed of the herb cuminum, siminum, a member of the parsley family. A cumin plant is a herbaceous plant with the fruit containing a single seed. Well, fennel and all that, I don't know. I'll share the link, you can read all this up. I'm going to more important things now. The fruit is a sago. Sago is that. It's from a cycad plant, similar to a palm tree. This is actually Sabudana, sago. It is the seeds of the cones of the cycad plant, and it's a starch extracted from the pith of the sago palm stems. So sago is a seed and hence can be used on Ekadasi. Cheese like tussas, parmesan, mozzarella, feta, and with no animal rennet in them can be used. But usually I see here parmesan, tussas, they all have rennet. So mozzarella is the only one I saw without rennet. But maybe there are other, in other parts of the world, you can get parmesan without rennet. Probably, I do not know. Vanilla is a pod, the vessel that contains the seeds of a plant, not the seeds themselves. It is not a bean. So vanilla can be had. Buckwheat, quinoa, although it resembles a grain, it is technically a grass. Or tapioca, one must confirm that these items are not mixed with grains and then you can eat them. So ingredients that one can't consume on Ekadasi. As a rule of thumb, we suggest you avoid products like ready mixed masalas and ready ground products. This is simply because products like ready ground hing are sometimes mixed with rice flour, which renders them unusable on Ekadasi. We therefore suggest that you use only whole products like pure resin hing. See, it's resin. Resin means like, you know, like a sap of a tree, resin. Like pure resin hing on Ekadasi, any type of grains, viz. Cereal, bread, wheat, flour, rice, not to say you can't use it. What is that? Rice, sorry. Any types of grains with cereal, bread, wheat, flour, rice, dals, roti, chapati, all types of beans. Masala, not to say you can't use it. Yes, if you make your own masala like we have given above. I don't recommend the masala of the Deepikas because they put mustard and sesame seeds. So if you make your own masala with the Ekadasi ingredients, that's fine, but I would not recommend purchasing it from shops, including I think Deepika's, as these have powdered grains in it. Green beans, what is this? Green beans, coffee, why even coffee is here? You don't know. Maybe for the non-devotees. Green beans, coffee or typical tea like five roses. Onions and garlic, any type of meat and alcohol, these are all for non-devotees. I think even that green tea was maybe for non-devotees, I don't know. But actually green tea is an intoxicant. So in Ekadasi we cannot take that. But he said green tea can take, I don't know, that's rubbish, complete rubbish. So anyway, onions and garlic, any type of meat and alcohol, spices like powdered hing, powdered shop turmeric, that means turmeric powdered in a shop, powdered shop turmeric. Cheeses with animal rennet in them, like most of the normal clover cheeses. You have to really look at the ingredients, I'm telling you. You have to be like really very scrutinizingly, like really be very harsh with the ingredients and take only the allowed ones. Even not for Ekadasi, even normally, if you're buying something which is a processed product, really look at all the, and sometimes there are numbers E571, all these things, 471, which is like considered beef, which is there in ice creams. That is not. So many things to consider, you know. There's a list of all those additives, the food additives they use, and where it comes from, and all, where they come from. So we need to keep track of all of that when we are, if we are really buying something from a shop. Some milk powders, it is found, generally contains soya lecithin. Yeah, so that's what I'm saying. A derivative of soya grain. Corn starch, so milk powders we can't use. At least the one we get it from New Zealand milk powder here, that definitely has soya lecithin. Corn starch, often used as a sweetener in many products, they cannot be used. Soft drinks. Starches made from corn or grains and products made from and mixed with these starches like ground spices and hing, baking soda, baking powder. Starches made from baking. Oh, baking soda and baking powder. Wow, I didn't know that. Custard, certain yogurts, puddings, cream cheese, candy. Do not use any cooking ingredients that may have been mixed with grains such as ghee that has been used to fry puris or spices or salt touched by hands dusted with flour. So these things cannot be taken. I don't know why he did not mention. Even brinjal cannot be taken. I don't know for what reason. Don't ask me. It somehow happened, sneaked itself into the list. I do not know how, but it did. So you can't take a brinjal on Ekadashi. And what else? That's what I remember. So again, then gray area ingredients. These are, you're not sure whether they can be followed, because some say can, some say cannot. So let's see what they are. The ingredients below are in the gray department. Gray department. And you can use your own discretion to consume them or not. It seems everyone has an opinion on them on the below. Some authorities advise not to consume tomatoes, which by the way is a fruit and not a vegetable. Yeah, actually if you go to Gaudiya Math, or even before that, they don't even take potatoes, carrots, anything that grows beneath the ground, like the Jains, you know. And also tomatoes and cauliflower and cabbage, because they say it's Western vegetables, something like that, not in the East, something. They actually have many more restrictions, but we don't have. Thankfully, Srila Prabhupada, you know, gave us some chance to breathe, seeing that we are fallen souls, you know. Some authorities advise not to consume tomatoes, which by the way is a fruit, carrots, potatoes, cauliflower, eggplant, turnips and beetroots, figs, pumpkin, ladyfingers and spinach and other leafy vegetables, but I don't see the grains in these foods. He's put in all caps. Yeah, so actually we use carrots, we use tomatoes, we use potatoes, we don't use eggplants though. We use turnips, we use beetroots, we use figs, we use pumpkin, lady's fingers, spinach, I think we use, I'm not sure. So for me, common sense always prevails. So that's what he's saying. Srila Prabhupada said, stay away from beans and grains. So he's saying, keep it simple. Eggplant. Vaishnavas of the Lakshmi Sampradaya, Sri Sampradaya, tend to avoid eggplant, so does lots of South Indian temples. Somehow it came into our thing also. We also don't eat brinjal. Sesame seeds, till. Sesame seeds come from sesame in. So for him it's a grey area, but for us it's like no, it's a no-go for us. So it is cultivated for its edible seeds, which grow in pods. As the name suggests, it's a seed and not a grain. So he says, Srila Prabhupada, use sesame seeds, mustard seeds. Again, where exactly Prabhupada used, so we need to know if there is an exact recorded thing, event or a conversation or something like that, where a pastime or something, then we need to look at those things, but we don't use. So it's better not to use. See, again, the point again is, if something is not sure, if you're not sure about it, just don't use it. It's the best formula. Mustard seeds. Mustard black seeds come from Brassica nigra plant. As the name suggests, it's a seed and not a grain. Srila Prabhupada often used mustard seeds. Yamuna Devi used mustard seeds in her Ekadashi recipes. Well, I did not check Yamuna Devi's Ekadashi recipes. Maybe it's true. Maybe Prabhupada used it. I don't know. But some say Prabhupada did not use it. One who actually served with Prabhupada, he says, no, Prabhupada said we should not use it. But then he says here we can use it, so better not use it. We are not using it. Oils. Reading the above on mustard and sesame oils should not answer whether we can use these oils or not. So any oils from the seeds, I mean grains, mustard oil we don't use because it's mustards we don't use. Sesame oil also we don't use because sesame we don't use. Soya oil of course we never use at all, even though it's not even Ekadasi we don't use. What are the other oil? Yeah, so any oil from grains. And then, Srila Prabhupada used sesame seeds, mustard seeds and peanuts. Again, we somehow tend to disagree with that. But peanuts, yes, peanuts can be used. Refer to Yamuna's table cookbook. So, he has given some reference here. Maybe we can find out there. But again, it's a controversial topic. So, because some devotees will accept it, some devotees will not accept it. We will not die without having, you know, sesame or mustard seeds on that day. After all, it is so small, even if you take one, it is not going to really, you know, solve your hunger problem. So, it hardly makes any difference after all. So, we can live without mustard and sesame seeds for a day at least, you know. So, that's what I feel. So, I think we can do away with these things. But then, because the article is about what should and should not be used, so he is covering all these things as he understood it. But then there have been counter arguments for these things in the comment section which are not included here. Peas. A pea is most commonly the small spherical seed or the seed pod of the legume Pisum sativum. Each pod contains several peas. Pea pods are botanically a fruit since they contain seeds developed from the ovary of a pea flower. Now, one devotee actually commented on this, saying that, see, he is saying botanically it's a fruit and seed or this or that. He is taking two different standards, the Western standards of classification and the Vedic standards of what is a grain or what. Because in Navadhanya, sesame is considered one of the grains. So, and mustards, these are all considered grains. So, although Western botany, I don't know how it is pronounced. So, Western botany may classify it as something else, maybe Vedic classification is different. So, that also can cause these confusions. So, we better stick to our Vedic viewpoint, because if there are two different standards classifying things, then we are bound to get into conflicts. Conflicting classifications of the same thing. So one devotee actually commented like that. So I think that is a wise comment as well, because he's, you know, doing Western and Vedic. Since they contain seeds developed from the ovary of a pea flower. However, peas are considered to be a vegetable in cooking. So, you see, it's botanically a fruit, he's saying, but in cooking, it's a vegetable. But on the other hand, if we consume peas, then we can have dal, isn't it? But dal is not allowed on Ekadasi. So, you see, the peas is classified as a grain, a flower and a vegetable, a fruit and a vegetable at the same time. So we stick to Vedic understanding. If peas are said to be grains, we just take them as grains and just avoid them. We will not die. But dal is not allowed in Ekadasi. As we know from the kathas of Ekadasi, that Papa Purusha, sin personified, hides only in grains on the day of Ekadasi and not in seeds and so forth. This one is seriously tricky. It is true that it is not a grain but a legume and therefore falls into the bean family. However, it is true that Srila Prabhupada extended the definition of grain to not just rice but all grain in the form of wheat, barley, beans, etc. To be safe, it is worth avoiding. Pseudo grains and flours that may be used on Ekadasi, courtesy Kurma Prabhu, kurma.net. Actually, Kurma Prabhu is a very great, very well known chef and Prabhupada's disciple, and he wrote books also on recipes. Amaranth flour, that Rajgira atta, is also considered. It is milled from the seeds of amaranth plant. This flour boasts a higher percentage of protein than most other grains, and you see, it has more proteins than other grains even, and has more fiber than wheat and rice. It is also higher in the amino acid lysine, which some food scientists believe makes it a more complete protein than flour made from other grains. amaranth flower can be used in cookies, crackers, baking mixes and cereals. Amaranth can also be purchased as a puffed cereal in whole food shops. Arrowroot flower, the rootstocks of a tropical plant are the source of this flower, often used as a thickener for sauces and desserts. The finely powdered arrowroot turns completely clear when dissolved, giving gloss to sauces and adds no starchy flavor. Because of its easy digestibility, it is also used as an ingredient in cookies intended for infants and young children. You can use it as a grain-free substitute to corn flour. We actually never used arrowroot flour. Maybe we can try. Buckwheat flour. A common ingredient in pancake mixes, buckwheat flour is also used to make Japanese soba noodles. It's available in light, medium and dark varieties. The dark flour boasts the strongest flavor, depending on the kind of buckwheat it is milled from. You can make your own buckwheat flour by processing whole white buckwheat groats in a blender or food processor. Buckwheat groats use only the dehusked variety. Can be cooked like rice. Yeah, buckwheat grains actually can be cooked like rice, but it has to be the dehusked one. I have eaten it in Russia. Very, very nice and tasty and very nutritious, and it's very filling. You know, of course, that's not the point of Ekadasi. It's all about fasting. But, you know, if you're especially traveling and we actually just traveled and it was very, very, very hungry, and even if we fasted, we couldn't do any service. The whole point is doing service. So we needed something, and the Mataji prepared buckwheat, and when we ate, it was very, very nice and it gave us all the energy back. Chestnut flour. This tan flour is made from chestnuts, the meaty low-fat nuts that are often served as a vegetable. The flour is a little sweet and is traditionally used in Italian holiday desserts. Italian shops sell it. Potato flour, it can be used. I don't know why he mentioned all this in the gray area, but this can be used. Potato flour can be used, chestnut flour, and all this can be used. Steamed potatoes. So potato flour is made like this. Steamed potatoes are dried and then ground to a powder to make this gluten-free flour, which is commonly used in baked goods for Jewish Passover when wheat flour may not be used. So quinoa, pronounced quinoa. Okay, thank you. Quinoa. Okay, that's how it's pronounced. Quinoa flour, higher in fat than wheat flour. Quinoa flour makes baked goods moister. You can make your own quinoa flour by processing whole quinoa in a blender. Stop before the flour is too fine. It should be slightly coarse. Anyway, he's giving all this. And then tapioca flour, dried from the starch of the cassava root. You can read all these things. I'll share the link. So, water chestnut flour. And what else? The Asian ingredients. Water chestnut flour. The Asian ingredient is a fine powdery starch that is used to thicken sauces and to coat foods before frying to give them a delicate crisp coating. So, coming to the conclusion. Of course, the above won't be an issue if you just consume milk and fruits for the day, which I highly recommend. You can actually avoid yourself a lot of headache. Otherwise, the whole day you're just worrying, what can I eat, and doing all this research instead of doing research on Krishna's pastimes and, you know, enjoying Krishna's pastimes or reading about them. We're doing research on what I can eat and cannot eat, and so the whole thing becomes bodily, you know, bodily concept. So best is to not worry so much and then just chant more, read more, do more service. So conclusion. Of course, the above won't be an issue if you just consume milk and fruits for the day, which I highly recommend. In conclusion, we should like to sum up the debate on the observance of Ekadasi with the following thoughts. There can be no question of the benefits of observing Ekadasi. Every relation of the benefits of the day shows that even those who accidentally or inadvertently observe the day have derived enormous benefit. Therefore, on this day, let us immerse ourselves in the thoughts of the Lord and in reduced eating. For as long as the Ekadasi fasting does not become Ekadasi feasting, one will derive benefits. We would advise to start slowly by initially giving up grains and then progressing to consuming only one grain-free meal on Ekadasi. If possible, and if one desires it, one can work oneself up to fasting every Ekadasi as Nirjala Ekadasi. This, however, is the gold standard which many will never achieve, unfortunately. Therefore, let us focus Let the focus of this most holy day rather be the thoughts of the Lord rather than sidestepping a minefield of prohibited foods. We can advise you about what to eat or not, but ultimately you must make your own decision on what to consume or not. Remember again, my humble advice is rather simple, and this should be the thumb rule on Ekadashi. If you consider something as grain, then just don't consume. So with that, I would like to conclude the session. Thank you very much for keeping up and bearing with me for all this while. 2.5 hours, 2 hours 40 minutes in fact. So any questions? We have a few. Pavitra Mataji. Two questions. One, regarding the narrations of Varuthini Ekadashi, it's written is to follow the rules and regulations since Dasami and also on Dvadashi, like eating once and many things. What should we do exactly to achieve the merits of Ekadashi? So yeah, so each of the Ekadashis have a different story. Like there is one Ekadashi called Shattila Ekadashi. So in that you can eat till, so sesame seeds. In other Ekadashis you can't. So, but we just don't eat in all Ekadashis. So in fact, I don't know the stories of each and every of those 26 Ekadashis. Each of those 26 Ekadashis have stories. And maybe there can be another session where we can do that. But I don't think it will finish in one session, 26. So, but for us, we will just do, ours is a general rule, all the way. You know, all Ekadashis, that is the base standard that Prabhupada set up. Okay, follow this for all Ekadashis. And for Pandava Nirjala Ekadashi, one should do Nirjala Ekadashi. And otherwise, it's just normal Ekadashi. If you can do Nirjal, well and good, best. But if you can't, then follow these things. And eat very simply and chant. In the Vaishnava calendar, there is a story regarding the Ekadashis. Do we need to follow that exactly? No, as I said, because it's stated in the Shastras, we will read it. But we don't follow the particular exact rules for each Ekadashi because Srila Prabhupada did not enforce it. Many things, actually, if you want to follow the Shastras, we can hardly follow any of these vratas. Even our chanting, you know. There is a story of Jagannath Das Babaji. He said he wanted to purify his chanting. And you know what he did? For 3 months, he wanted to chant from morning sunrise to evening sunset continuously for 3 consecutive months. So he was doing that. Without talking, and without passing air, without eating, without even a drop of water for all this time. And after the sunset, yes, one can take a little bit of water and some a little bit food like that. So he was doing it, and 2 months he did. And then in the day, by mistake, he said something just to his servant, just said something. Or then he realized, oh no, I have spoken. Then he said, no. Again, from that day he started, another 3 months. So he said, this Purascharya is the only method by which our chanting can be purified. So if you want to really follow, if you want to really get to the, you know, rules, the rules are so strict. But see, Srila Prabhupada gave us, even 64 rounds, that is also a rule. Where is our 64 rounds? So 16 rounds only. So everything Srila Prabhupada gave us, he is merciful not because he has reduced the austerity so that we can chant less. He is merciful because even if we are so fallen, he is agreeing to take us back to Godhead. That doesn't mean we will try to slacken even more, and then we just follow the base standard. All those different stories, we can read them as part of the, because they are part of the scriptures, but then we don't need to follow everything. What is given by Sadhu Shastra Guru? According to the time and circumstance, the Guru will give accordingly the instructions on what Shastric injunctions to follow. Right? I think that makes it clear. Sunita Sharma Mataji. So she's asking, can you take medicines on Ekadasi? They might contain grains but should be taken every day. Yeah, so for medicines it's a different thing. And even sometimes pregnant women, they can't subsist on grainless food. So these special cases are different. Yes, you can take medicines. Prabhupada also, he never say you cannot take medicines. So medicines, yes, you can take. If one is sick, then he has to, you know, take medicines. So you can take medicines. Sunita Sharma, is there a full list of items that can be eaten on Ekadasi? Well, we just went through the whole list. I will share with you the list. The formatting was not nice, and some of the things I will take out, like sesame and mustard seeds, which definitely are not to be taken, so I will take that out. And we will share the list with you in a day or two, because I'll just make the formatting all nice, and I'll share it in the link as a link to in the description of this video on Facebook and YouTube, so you can you can follow that. Jagannath Prabhu, for Nirjal Ekadasi, is it okay to take Charanamrita and can take water while doing Achaman? Yes. So Achaman is when you put on tilak, and when you go into the altar, you must first do Achaman. So that Achaman water can be taken, and Charanamrita you must take. Charanamrita is so important that even while fasting, we have to take Charanamrita. Krishna Balram Prabhu, what happens and what to do next if anyone accidentally or forgot it is Ekadasi and take grains? And Prabhupada said you must fast on Dvadasi the whole day as if it was Ekadasi. So that's the best atonement. But yeah, if it is by mistake, so to fast the whole Dvadasi, that is the proper way. And also one has to read one chapter of Bhagavad Gita. So that is the proper atonement. Premikash Prabhu, it is for those devotees staying in village, sometime in the village milkmaid use mustard oil to hands sliding down easily to take milk taken time from cows. So devotees are very careful of that, who buying milk from other hand, which is should not use for Ekadasi day, which is, but if it is more safe if we have our own cows and milk. So what he is saying is, in villages, I did not know this, so he is telling this. So, you know, when you have to excuse me, my knees are really hurting because every day sitting for like 3 hours. So what he is saying is, you know, when you milk the cows, you put some oil on your hand so that it glides smoothly, so that it won't rupture the cow's udder. So sometimes in the villages, it seems, and especially mustard seeds are usually used in Bengal. So he's coming from Bangladesh. So it is a common practice there, I think, from his statement, that they use mustard oil to, you know, milk the cow. Then mustard oil will go into the milk for sure. Can go into the milk for sure. So in that case, so he's saying we must be careful where we buy the milk from. Although it is pure milk from the cow, but still, if it is mustard oil used for milking the cow, then again that's a problem. So we have to be careful. Unless we have our own cow and we know what we're doing, then it's a different thing. So that's a good point, actually. I didn't know that. So city people, we don't know this. Those who are in village, they know the practical things about life. We, if we don't have a supermarket, we don't know where to get the milk from, we don't know where to get the vegetables from, we don't know where to get the rice from, we can't plant anything, we'll just die. But those in villages, they actually know how to live. We know big things, but we don't know how to live, simply. So basic life skills we don't have. So anyway, I think that's it for the day, that's it for the session. And I don't know if anything else is there. Thank you all for patiently waiting. I think some of them already left. Of course, Vishwambhu Prabhu has shared many quotations from Haribhakti Vilas. From the age of 8 to the age of 80, a person should fast on all of the Ekadasis, on both the light and the dark parts of the month. So, in like this, there is it okay if you offer only fruits on Ekadasi to Krishna? So, actually, Krishna must be offered everything. But of course, you can give that offerings, you can keep it for the next day. Even grains, actually, Krishna can be offered everything. But of course, you can offer only fruits to Krishna also on Ekadasi. But actually, for Krishna, there is no fasting. So even in temple, we offer everything, even the grains. But the grains, they can be distributed to those who are not devotees, those who don't know anything about anything. And at home, basically, you can just offer fruits. It's not a problem. You know, you can offer fruits and to Krishna and then eat them like that. All right. Thank you very much. Thank you for all your appreciations and all the classes. And please share these videos with others. So even if it's not live, they can still watch it and still they can benefit. And especially the videos on the morning program, please share it with others. Because the more people know about the importance of this, then they will become stronger devotees. So we can help others in this way. So thank you again. Jai Śrīla Prabhupāda ki jai. Ekādaśī-vrata ki jai. Nitāya Gaur Premānande.